ain't about Joe Taylor and Don Rowe. This is about HU. About us. Make sure we get what we gotta do, guys. Let's bring it up, bring it up, bring it up, bring it up.
You are watching ESPNU College Football Primetime presented by McDonald's. It is a gorgeous September evening here on the banks of the Chesapeake as Hampton plays host to Florida A&M. You see Joe Taylor there, the Rattlers head coach on the right. For 16 years, he was the head coach of Hampton and helped build this program up. Now he's on the enemy sidelines. With that, we say hello and welcome alongside former Howard quarterback Jay Walker. I'm Anish Shroff, and really FAMU and Hampton, two teams expected to contend in the MEAC. This is a pivotal early season showdown.
And I think both of these programs realize the magnitude of this football game. You got the big boys on top. South Carolina State and Bethune-Cookman are expected to win the conference. If you want to come in second so you can get that automatic bid to postseason play, it starts here tonight in MEAC play.
FAMU had nearly a hiccup in that first game. They were trailing against Fort Valley State, pulled out the victory. They couldn't run the ball in that game, which is usually a staple of Joe Taylor teams, but they were able to throw the ball very successfully.
Yeah, fortunately for them, they found a quarterback in Austin Trainer. Their quarterback came through big when they needed. They wanted to run the football, but Fort Valley State forced him to pass. He stepped up and threw for 348 yards and two touchdowns, including a crucial last-minute, two-minute drive.
Meanwhile, Hampton, they were able to run the ball in their opener against Alabama A&M. Their quarterback went over 100 yards, and so did their sophomore running back, Antoine Chisholm.
Antoine Chisholm was the newcomer of the year last season in the MEAC Conference, and in 2011, he's going right where he finished. He rushed for 149 yards last week versus Alabama A&M with a touchdown. He was the reason why the Pirates were able to come back victorious in Chicago.
And we are about set to kick it off here at Armstrong Stadium. Teron Durham to kick it off for Hampton. Devin Roberts, Al Tariq McPherse back deep for FAMU. And there is McPherse across the 20-yard line. Slips up near the 25-yard line. And we get to see FAMU on offense to start things out. And Jay, it all begins with the quarterback, Austin Trainer, as a sophomore. A terrific first game against Fort Valley State. You mentioned more than 340 yards, two TDs, also ran for a score. And this is a kid who last year, just two TD passes on the entire season compared with six interceptions.
And Florida A&M will not ask Trainer to throw the ball 33 times tonight if everything goes according to plan. We mentioned in the open, Joe Taylor's pedigree has always been balanced. He wants a 50-50 ratio between run and pass. Last week, they just had to force the ball down the field. Look for them to come out trying to establish the running game early tonight.
On first down, it is a run. It's Levante Page. Doesn't get much, maybe 2 yards. Tackled by the former Virginia Tech transfer, Lindell Gibson. Let's meet this Florida A&M offense. Eddie Rocker's the starting tailback, but we saw Levante Page get that first carry. Kevin Elliott, their go-to wide receiver, over 100 yards receiving in the season opener. And up front, FAMU, boy, they have four FBS transfers, two from Central Florida, one from Western Kentucky, and then one from Marshall. Eddie Rocker now back in the game. Four wide receivers here on second and eight. It's Rocker, and he gets to maybe the 27, 28-yard line. It'll bring up third down. Jamie Curry Slaughter and Lindell Gibson on the slot, on the stop, rather. And Curry Slaughter, him and Ian Davidson, a lot on their shoulders, especially up front now that Kenrick Ellis is a member of the New York Jets. Gibson started for Virginia Tech a year ago in that secondary. Two seniors, a junior, and a redshirt freshman who the team is very high on in Courtney Bridget Jr. He's a UNLV transfer. Third and six. Trainer to throw. Now we'll tuck it and run. And he's going to be taken down shy of the first down. And boy, he takes a big hit by Delbert Tyler, Hampton's top returning tackler from a year ago.
Yeah, that was one there where Trainer just made a poor decision on where to go with the football in his pre-snap read. He was looking to the right, trying to get the ball to Kevin Elliott. He was double covered, and then that allowed Delbert Tyler to come off the edge and make the big hit to stop him short of the first down.
So three and out for Florida A&M. Hampton will get the ball here back deep to receive for Hampton is Cambrell McGee. Brandon Holdren to punt. McGee from his own 20. Does a little dance, but doesn't get very far. And Hampton will take over. So we get a first look at this Hampton offense, Jay, and it's a new look offense with new offensive coordinator Willie Snead.
And one thing that they want to do is speed, 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 speed. This is one of the most high-octane offenses you're going to see. They want to try and run about 80 plays per game. To tell you what that means, on average, a good offensive unit will run 60 offensive plays. If you can get it anywhere close to 80, that's a high-speed offense.
Four wide receivers on first down. This is Javaris Brown trying to find some room, and he scampers forward after a gain of about 2 yards. Legree's the quarterback for Hampton. These are his skill players. He's got Chisholm, who is the reigning MEAC Rookie of the Year. Javaris Brown, who just caught that last ball, the team's top returning receiver. And then up front, a lot of youth on that offensive line. Three freshmen, a sophomore, and a junior. Legree, pump fakes, throws to Chisholm out of the backfield. Chisholm finds some space out of seemingly nothing. And he got maybe two, third and six now coming up. Let's meet the FAMU defense. They feature a 3-4 D. Patrick Scott starting at nose tackle. There was some thought he may not play due to an injury. Demarius Folsom considered the playmaker in that linebacker unit. And John Ojo had two picks in FAMU's season opener. Third and six for Hampton. Legree over the middle, and just a bit too strong for Brown. So both teams go three and out early.
Yeah, very difficult to try and get your play count up if you go with three and outs. And you'll see right away, one thing we noticed with David Legree, the transfer quarterback for Hampton University from Syracuse, he's got a strong arm. He's got the pro size, 6 feet, 5 inches, 230 pounds, but you got to convert on those first downs. And the one thing the coaches said they really like about him the most going into his senior year, an attitude adjustment. He's become more of a leader, and they're going to need his leadership in this football game.
Jordan Stovall to kick it away. Jeremy Tillman back deep for FAMU. Tillman muffs the punt. Who's got it? Hampton's got it. So FAMU turns it over, and Hampton takes over inside the Florida A&M 35-yard line. It was John Rose getting in there for the Pirates.
Well, one thing that Hampton has, which will confuse you, they've got a left-footed kicker doing that rugby-style kick. So that ball's up there floating like a knuckleball, and you can tell, just got up on him, tried to catch it with his hands. He was moving to the right too much, couldn't get underneath it.
Jay, when we talked to Joe Taylor, FAMU's head coach, yesterday, what did he tell us? He was worried about the special teams. That was a concern.
Yeah, I mean, that's something that he does a good job on year in, year out, but doesn't have the confidence as he's had in previous years with this special team unit. On the flip side, his protege, Don Rose, said the same thing. Hey, we got to win special teams, and they're off to a good start.
Isaiah Thomas with the catch in the flat. He gets down inside the 20-yard line. 12 yards and a Hampton first down. So we're seeing this quick strike attack, this Willie Snead offense for Hampton.
Yeah, coming off the turnover. And look how quickly he gets rid of this big, strong arm, catchable pass. Thomas does a good job of getting some positive yardage after the catch.
Back to the no huddle. This is Legree. He'll try to keep it himself. Trying to get the corner, and he's forced out of bounds. No game.
And I think that's a dimension that people don't expect from David Legree. You know, you look at his size, 6'5", 230 pounds. You don't expect him to be a speed guy. He's not the fastest quarterback, but he's an efficient running quarterback. And last week against Alabama A&M, there were some key runs he had late in the game that allowed the Pirates to get some points on the board.
Hampton last year, 67% in the red zone. Here's Legree. Gonna throw deep. He's got a receiver, and it's caught by Reginald Hicks.
Yeah.
18 yards for Hicks. And Hampton on the board first. He got that corner of the end zone.
That was a big throw. Look at him on the opposite field hash, throwing that ball all the way across the football
and
field.
And he just tiptoed in.
That's not easy to do, Anish. You've got to have some arm strength to get that ball all the way across the field. Legree showing you that big-time cannon of a right arm.
Point after by Durham is good, and Hampton capitalizes off the Florida A&M turnover. A miffed punt leads to a Pirates possession, and Legree to Hicks, 7-0 Hampton.
When you join.
18-yard touchdown pass from David Legree to Reginald Hicks, the senior, a local kid from Hampton. And it's the hometown Pirates with a 7-0 lead here in the first quarter with Jay Walker and Ish Schropp. Jay, take us through the play.
You know, I'm really impressed at the arm strength. He's on one hash. Now, football field is 53 yards across. So if you're going to make this throw 20 yards down the field, all the way across the field, that takes a major arm strength. Step into the throw, good pocket. You don't draw it up any better than this. And good job by Hicks of tiptoeing the line, making sure he stayed in to get the score.
And those are 7 points off of turnover, something to watch. FAMU muffing the punt. Three plays, 32 yards later, Hampton capitalizes. Hampton set to kick it off. It'll be Teron Durham once again to send it deep. Al Tariq McBurson, Jordan Stanley waiting at their own 10-yard line for FAMU. McBurse from the 7. Across the 25 and tripped up at about the 36, but there's a flag on the play. Let's see what the penalty is.
On the return team, number 40, 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul, first down.
So it's on FAMU and penalties. Boy, that was the story after their week one win.
And that's something that Coach Taylor had to work on. He knew that going into this game. Last week they were penalized 19, repeat that, 19 times last week in one football game. And they still won, but they also realized that's not the recipe for success. And Joe Taylor coached teams normally don't have that many penalties in a game.
On first down, Trainer throws. The ball's deflected, hung up there forever, but it's incomplete. Kevin Elliott, the intended receiver. Those 19 penalties, Jay, 207 penalty yards.
Man, that means
even the Oakland Raiders don't do that.
The yellow flags have more yards on the ground than the Hampton offensive unit did, or the Florida A&M offense, pardon me. But that's something that you can't do and expect to win football games. They got away with it last week, but you can't do that moving forward.
On second and 10, this is McBurse. Trying to get to the outside, but met by a swarm of blue shirts. Delbert Tyler led the charge.
And it's going to be very tough running early on for Florida A&M until they can loosen up the Hampton Pirate defense. They've got 8 guys around the line of scrimmage. McBurse does a good job. He makes the first guy miss and makes something out of nothing. But look at all the blue jerseys there. You've got 5 blue jerseys there all around the line of scrimmage to make the tackle.
So third and 10 now.
Where's that third down? Oh!
4 receivers set for FAMU. And another flag.
And flag on play.
Preston Harding, the head referee.
We have offside defense, number 97. 5-yard penalty, still third down.
That's Ian Davidson, senior defensive tackle, former Maryland transfer. He's wearing Kenrick Ellis's old number.
Ooh, you talk about a big jersey to fill. Normally you say big shoes, big jersey. Kenrick Ellis was
triple
a big
XL.
Man. Yes, 4XL, no triple X in Kenrick Ellis.
out of the backfield, and it is dropped by Eddie Rocker. So FAMU, three and out for the second straight possession, but we do have another flag.
Late flag there as well. You know, if you're Hampton right now, the last thing you want to do is allow the Rattlers to pick up a first down by penalty. Let's see what the penalty call is.
Dead ball, personal foul, number one on the defense. That's a 15-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
You know, the guys there, incomplete. They're in the middle of that shoving match there. What do we say? It's always the second guy that gets caught. A little extra shove by the wide receiver on the attempted block, and then they catch Cambrell McGee trying to retaliate.
So a bit of a gift here for a FAMU offense that on the first six plays really couldn't move the ball.
Yeah, I mean, you can consider on third and 10, they caught Hampton jumping off sides for 5 yards and then got another 15 yards off the penalty. So the offense is yet to come up with a conversion. And what they're going to need to do is on first down passes, because right now Hampton's going to load the box on first down. You see the blue jerseys getting close. They've got seven guys within the box. Pretty tough to run on that. They're going to need to soften them up with the passing game.
Eddie Rocker right up the gut and nowhere to go.
Where can you go? You know, I mean, that's just simple math. If you've got five linemen and a running back, you've got five guys to block seven, there's just no room. I mean, look at this. Every hole is going to be crowded and clamped. Nowhere to go. You try and run the ball to the teeth of the defense, what's going to happen? You're going to get bitten. Two guys unblocked there to make the tackle. Rocker very fortunate to get back to the initial line of scrimmage.
Hampton, by its standards, had a so-so season last year. Defense was never the issue, though. It was the ability to score. And even this year, without Kenrick Ellis, without Brandon Pegues, this is still a very good defense.
And they're very aggressive, and they attack. You know, their defensive coordinator, Keith Gouganis, thought their defense was overshadowed at times last year.
Trainer nearly turned it over. Falls on it. Looked like a fake handoff there. Or maybe a little miscommunication.
You know, that's all the quarterback. Ball just came out of his hands, and even had he pulled that out, you had Matt Davis coming unblocked. He wasn't falling for the fake, so it would have been a sack anyway. The Rattlers are just very fortunate to keep the football.
So third and 16 from the 37. They have to get to that Hampton 47 for a first down. Trainer. Over the middle, and it's incomplete. Intended receiver, the freshman Lenworth Lennon.
And the Hampton Pirates showing that they have the ability to get pressure on the Florida A&M quarterback with just a four down lineman. The four front four doing the rush, nowhere for him to step into, and as soon as he releases it, they're there to make him pay, put a hit on him. The new number 97 for Hampton University, Ian Davidson with the hit.
Davidson blocked the kick against Alabama A&M in the waning seconds to preserve the win. Cambrell McGee back deep for Hampton. From his own 18. Here's McGee, and he slips at the 27-yard line. That's where Hampton takes over. When we come back, the Pirates are fired up. 7:53 to go. They're up 7-0.
So you're 2:30.
ESPNU's college football primetime is presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it. And in part by Lexus. It's time to engineer amazing. There's the new Hampton locker room. Pirates quarterback David Legree, a former Syracuse transfer, said the locker room in Hampton better than the one he had while playing for the Orange.
Well, hey, he's leaving something there to, that's saying something. Very nice locker room. And you see the defensive coordinator for Hampton, Keith Gouganis, telling the troops, keep it going, keep the pressure on. Very aggressive Pirate defense.
Legree on first down, under pressure. He'll tuck it and run. Across the 35 and out of bounds near the 40-yard line. 13 yards and a first down for Hampton.
Great job by David Legree of having the pocket presence to know where the pressure's coming from, slide to the left in his pocket, and then realize nobody's accounting for the quarterback in the running game. picking up positive yardage, getting the first down for the Pirates.
That's what the coaching staff told us yesterday. He picks his spots better now. He's trusting in this offense.
With the new offensive coordinator, normally it takes 3 or 4 games before you get that complete trust, but they say he's been such a workaholic in the classroom that his football IQ has shown the ability to pick it up, and he's comfortable week one.
Here's the blitz. Legree picks it up, finds Isaiah Thomas near sideline, and he's pushed out of bounds at about the 44-yard line, a gain of 4 yards.
He sees the blitz is coming, but he's not worried about it. I'm going to my quick hitch right away. Ball's in my hand for less than a second. Get it to my playmakers on the outside. One thing defensive coordinators hate are completed passes on pressure.
Here's Chisholm on 2nd and 6. Breaks 2 tackles across midfield into FAMU territory. Still on his feet and down inside the 45-yard line. 21 yards and another first down by last year's MEAC Rookie of the Year.
Watch him get to the hole, then change directions. Nothing's there. Good move on the linebacker. Makes 2 Rattlers miss, then turns on the speed to the outside with a nice low center of gravity. He's very difficult to bring down.
Hampton uses a no huddle. Here's Legree. Fights off a couple of defenders, and he may have gotten a yard before Nicholas Hollinghead took him down.
No, you got to take a look. That's where Hampton, they get you off balance. They hit you with a big play, then they line up again on the line of scrimmage, and they're running plays rapid fire, trying to get that ball snapped before 20 seconds goes on the play clock.
Talking to offensive coordinator Willie Snead yesterday, he said his offense, it's Texas Tech meets Oregon meets Florida. High-paced, fast-paced. High tempo. Chisholm. Man, he runs right into the teeth of that Rattler defense.
And I like his analogy for it. He said, you know, the passing game is like high speed like Texas Tech. The running game is high tempo like Oregon. And then the formation-wise, you know, using the Florida formation. Where
think Tim Urban Tebow, Meyer, Florida.
Urban Meyer, Florida, yes, yes. Not Charlie Weiss, Florida. That's NFL style. This Urban Meyer, Florida, multiple formations, different sets.
On 3rd and 10, Legree throws and way over the head of Reginald Hicks. So 4th down coming up for the Pirates, giving their field position a bit of a decision here, Jay.
I mean, this is one where you got to know your special teams unit. If you've got a kicker with a big leg, then you go for it. Flag
on the play. And now a flag coming in late.
A lot of explaining going with a penalty.
Yeah, it didn't seem like anything was going on. Didn't seem like anything was going on, but we just saw the one official throw the flag near where David Legree was standing.
There's no foul on the defense. No foul for illegal substitution on the defense.
So no penalty, it remains 4th and 10, and the offense remains out on the field.
Yeah, I think, you know, this is an area here they may not trust the pooch punt. If you miss the pooch punt, you only gain 11 yards. Why not take a chance going downfield, try to pick up the first down?
And Hampton's defense has been so good early on as well. Empty backfield. Legree under pressure. He's got some room to run. And Legree dives forward for the first down. They spread him out, and it was the quarterback going straight up the gut.
Yeah, initially I thought he left the pocket too soon. He didn't give it a chance to develop, but he run with determination. Look at this. Once he decides to take off, make the decision, go, know where the first down marker is, and use that big frame to get across the yards.
Here's Chisholm inside the 20 in Hampton in the red zone for the second time this evening. A gain of 3 on first down.
I mean, that was a gutsy run by David Legree there. Big time run. You need that much yardage. He knew where the marker was, and he got picked it up.
Chisholm again. Finds some space. And he gets to about the 13-yard line. 3rd and about 2 coming up.
And you know, now they're stepping on the gas pedal. They're trying to wear out this Florida A&M defense. 3 consecutive runs, and if they're able to pick up the first down running the ball 3 consecutive times with Chisholm, that can be deflating to a defensive unit.
Versus Verizon in the red zone. Hampton 1-for-1 tonight with a touchdown. Last season they were 67% in these situations. 3-for-3 last week. Fourth and one, second fourth down conversion coming up of the drive. Legree, the big guy, will keep it himself. He falls forward, and it's a Hampton first down, 2 yards, and they get the ball to the 10-yard line. First and goal.
How did he get through that hole? I mean, Chisholm was the lead, and he got smacked behind the line of scrimmage. Legree able to make that big frame small and pick up the first down.
Now they'll spot it just outside the 10, so it's first and 10. Hampton technically can still get a first down here. Flag on the play, and it looked like somebody jumped on offense.
We have false start, number 55 on the offense, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Number 55, that's Norman Booker, a redshirt freshman. We talked about the youth on this O-line, 3 freshmen and a sophomore.
And of the youth, not one of the offensive linemen for Hampton started a game for him last year.
Legree throws far sideline, completes to Dyree McCain.
That's how you go through your progressions. That's the same route they threw the touchdown on earlier. This time, Florida A&M made the adjustment. They covered Hicks, but they left McClain open on the flat. Saw the deep throw wasn't there, came right down to McCain, pick up positive yardage.
Second down now. McLeod, Antonio McLeod, first carry of the game, no gain. So now third down coming up, and Jay Walker, third down. You can still get a first down, but essentially need a touchdown here.
Yeah, and this is one where their small offensive line has not been able to push the Florida A&M defensive line back, so they're pretty much regulated to just throwing the football down here in the red zone.
Legree over the head of Antoine Chisholm, and it'll be fourth down, and now we'll see the kicking team.
And Chisholm had daylight. Had he been able to get that ball to Chisholm in stride with the type of explosiveness that Antoine Chisholm has, that very easily could have been a touchdown. Take a look. There's nobody around him. Just get this ball where you can hit him in stride. You know, you give a guy like Chisholm that much room and space with blockers down the field, that could have been a touchdown for six.
Teron Durham on for the kick. It's a 24-yarder. Durham's kick is up and good. Big leg by the junior college transfer. Hampton has now scored on its last 2 drives, and Donovan Rose's Pirates with a 10-0 lead with 3:22 to go in the first.
College.
They trash-talking that game with big words.
Yeah, well, you know, I don't know.
SAT words.
Yeah, and, you know, if I was Duke, I wouldn't do too much of the talking when you've got probably the best college football player coming to town. That Kentucky game, Kentucky, they better not play to the level of their competition like they did last week. Very fortunate to beat Western Kentucky.
FAMU's Al-Tariq McBurse across the 20-yard line. Gets to about the 30-yard line, and that's where Florida A&M will start. Jay, you were talking about Andrew Luck, 3 new starters on the offensive line. Some questions in the receiving corps this year.
But there's been a more well-rounded NFL prospect quarterback since John Elway than Andrew Luck.
How about Peyton Manning?
We have
Peyton Manning was there.
On the kicking team, number one, re-kick, five.
And I think, you know, the reason we all know Manning went number one overall, but he never had the mobility that Andrew Luck had. You know, Andrew Luck's got the mobility running, so he's pretty well put together and pretty highly ranked.
That was Cambrell McGee called for offside, so Hampton will kick it off once again. Second time McGee's been flagged in this game. And right now, that's the only break FAMU can get against Hampton is when the Pirates commit a penalty.
Yeah, because right now, Hampton has the ability to move the ball. They've scored on 2 consecutive drives. And this Florida A&M offense is yet to convert an offensive a first down. So right now, they're struggling, relying upon the yellow flags to come out against Hampton.
So Teron Durham will now kick from his own 25. And the return men have moved up to the 15 and the 20. Now Tariq McBurse retreats back inside his own 10-yard line. And he's tripped up as he was coming strong across that 20-yard line. It's an 18-yard return, and FAMU's offense will try to get the ball moving here. Jay, how about this? FAMU so far has run 8 plays for a total of 2 yards. Hampton on the other end, 20 plays for 109 yards.
And that's just one quarter, and that's really the story of this football game. The inept offense for Florida A&M.
They've hardly been on the field.
Yes, and, you know, special teams haven't helped them out either. And you've got an offense for Hampton that last week got off to a slow start. Well, they shook off all that rust, and they're continuing the momentum they gained in the second half of that contest against Alabama A&M a week ago.
McBurse, the deep back in the eye.
Oh, look at that. They've crowded that box. 8 guys around the line of scrimmage.
And how about McBurse carrying tacklers with him to about the 33-yard line? Delbert Tyler finally wrestles him down. When we brought up Al-Tariq McBurse's name to the coaching staff, they lit up.
Yeah, I mean, you know, he's doing good running, but look at this. Those are 8 bodies within that box trying to stop the run. And he still finds a crease and manages to pick up positive yardage. That's one where you got to take your hats off to the front line for Florida A&M. If you can run against that type of pressure, then that lets them know you've got the ability to do it, but they've got to do it more consistently.
And for the first time, it's second and manageable for FAMU. Low snap. Trainer keeps it on the ground. This is Levante Page. And Page is going to be tackled short of a first down. It'll bring up third and short.
A good pursuit by the Pirate defense there with the low snap. Page very fortunate he even received that handoff.
Levante Page.
Outside of that big run they had on first down. They're just not clicking. There's no offensive chemistry right now for Florida A&M. Time for number 5 to step up. You see number 5 there, Kevin Elliott, their big play wide receiver. This is one when you've got a quarterback that's struggling. If you can get a one-on-one matchup, which they have down here on the bottom of your screen, look for him.
On third down, nowhere to go. Page taken down in the backfield. It's the Virginia Tech transfer, Lindell Gibson, getting him in the backfield for a loss of 2. Yeah, and FAMU's got a punt.
They're coming right down the middle of the defense. You'll see him, number 4. He's just going to time it up. This is Gibson right here. He's going to shoot the gap. How do you leave the opposing team's middle linebacker unblocked on third and short?
Hampton not quite ready to field that punt. FAMU with the quick kick. It takes a bounce at about the 30, and then it rolls dead at the 20-yard line. That's where Hampton will start with 1:02 to go here in the first quarter. So FAMU, 3 and out in their first possession, 3 and out on this possession, in between a possession that looked like a 3 and out, but a penalty extended it. Hey, don't forget Monday, the Palmer and Pollock Show debuts on ESPNU at 1 and 9 Eastern, as Jesse Palmer and David Pollock provide an engaging and interactive look at the past week's action and set the scene for the upcoming week's big games. Strap yourself in for an entertaining and opinionated 3-hour college football forum. College football lives here every day on ESPNU. First and 10 from the 20 for Hampton. Legree completes far sideline. That's Reginald Hicks.
And let's go back to that run stop. You're going to see Gibson here shoot the gap this way. What you've got to do is peel off and go up and get that man. That's your responsibility. Uncovered lineman, you've got to get him. You can't go down if you're number 72 for Florida A&M. That's Robert Hartley. Guy's right in your face. That's your gap, your responsibility. Hit somebody.
On second and 5. This is Javaris Brown, and he's taken down at about the 34-yard line. Good enough for a first down, 7 yards on the game, on the play.
And you notice how Hampton wears you out. We haven't seen a lot of throws down the middle of the field. Everything sideline to sideline, making the defense cover the whole field, and that'll tire you out, and they're doing a good job of that now in the first half. In the second half, this Florida A&M defense could be gassed.
Well, the FAMU defense was on the field for most of the first quarter, a first quarter dominated by Hampton. Donovan Rose and the Pirates with a 10-0 lead at the end of one.
Yulee battles Buford.
Start of the second quarter here at Armstrong Stadium with Jay Walker and Anish Roth. It's Hampton up 10-0. Hampton capitalizing off a Florida A&M turnover, turning that into an 18-yard touchdown pass from David Legree to Reginald Hicks, and then a Teron Durham field goal, making it 10-0. A first quarter dominated by the Pirates.
I mean, they did it on offense, they did it on defense, they did it on special teams. A very complete performance by Donovan Rose, Hampton Pirates in the first quarter.
Hampton outgained FAMU 126-8 in that first quarter. Second and six. And it looked like a Pirates player jumped. That looks like the right tackle, Paul Nicholson.
We have false start, number 58 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, second down.
That is Nicholson, one of three freshmen on this O-line. And that was one of the areas where Donovan Rose said he had some concern about his team. Very young up front. Legree, he's going to go deep. And too deep. Wanted Isaiah Thomas.
Legree did a good job of just getting rid of that football. The Rattlers brought pressure from his left side. He was able to sidestep the blitzing linebacker and get rid of that football. And that's one of those things that doesn't show up in your stat sheet, just a long incompletion, but it very easily should have been a sack. Tackle for loss behind the line of scrimmage, but he was able to get rid of the ball.
On third and 11 now, Legree throwing and over the head of Dyree McCain. So fourth down coming up.
That's a couple times where he's been
now
off the mark.
Flag on the play.
Personal foul, number four on the defense. That's a 15-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
This is number four, is Terry Johnson, and defenseless wide receiver. That's Reginald Hicks going across the formation. Ball wasn't intended for him. He's defenseless. They're going to call that every time.
And that play was over at that point. So now, instead of punting, Hampton has the ball at its own 46-yard line and a fresh set of downs. On the ground to Chisholm, and he gets maybe a yard. Second down and 9 coming up.
You know, the one thing I will say about the Florida A&M defense right now, this is the defense that's aggressive, and they've been getting pressure, and I think they've controlled the line of scrimmage. Their defensive front four seem to be a little bit stronger than the front five for Hampton. Coach Earl Holmes, the defensive coordinator, should be proud of the job his D-line is doing.
Here's McCain, and he gets into FAMU territory. To the 48-yard line, it'll bring up third down.
You know, when you talk about the Rattlers defense, they like to have that big strike defense. Six sacks last week versus Fort Valley State. Talk to the coaches. They said they could have had 10 sacks, but they missed the quarterback four times in the backfield.
Legree on third down, going to keep it. He's in trouble, and he's forced out of bounds. Back at his own 45-yard line, Alvis Graham getting into the backfield, and now Hampton faced with another fourth down.
Graham made the tackle, but take a look at number 98, Jerry Willis, coming right up the middle of your screen. He's going to do a stunt to the inside, disrupts that play, disrupts the handoff, gets to Legree's legs, forces Legree to go wide. Good move right there. Number 8, 98 in white. Willis just disrupted that play all on his own, and Alvis Graham came over to put him away.
Jordan Stovall to kick it away for Hampton. Jarrell Stewart back deep for FAMU.
He's a left-footed kicker. They got to remember it's going to come off a little bit different.
And it goes out of bounds. So FAMU will take over their first possession of the second quarter. When we come back, we'll see if their offense can do anything.
It's Cowboys 7-Zip. Anish.
Prove it.
All right, thank you very much, Mike. Here it's 10-0 Hampton against Florida A&M. Joe Taylor looking on. He knows Armstrong Stadium very well. Spent 16 seasons as Hampton's head coach. Won 5 MEAC titles. Guided this team from Division II to 1AA, now called the FCS. But now in his fourth season at FAMU, he said, as for the players, not much meaning there anymore. There's only a couple of guys on Hampton who played for
him. I think he said two to be exact, so I'd let you know. He's studying the other opponent's roster.
Austin Trainer throws, and it's incomplete, and Trainer still has not completed a pass.
And that's how you play middle linebacker. You know, if they want to send a fullback out into the flat, that's one-on-one coverage between Lindell Gibson going against Ronald Jackson, and Gibson should have the speed to outrun him and waited till the ball got there and put a good blow on him to dislodge him from that. And you take a look over on the Florida A&M sideline, that defense is starting to look at the offense like, give us some help.
Gibson's the Virginia Tech transfer. Not bad for a guy who defensive coordinator Keith Gogena said was still feeling out the system.
Still starting to learn the system. Well, he's looking pretty good right now. We saw him in pregames with those pads on. He's put together like a piece of granite.
And there's the first completion for Trainer. It's McPurse. He spins around, and I think he got spun around as Justin Blake takes him down. A short gain. It'll bring up third down and long.
And then McBurse, the transfer from Purdue University, they want to get him the ball in space. When all things are going bad, get it to a guy that can make some plays. And you see the explosive, quick first step and the determination to try and get some extra yardage. But when you've got three Pirate defenders trying to bring you down, very difficult to pick up any yards after the catch.
Give him three on second, so it's third and about seven. And movement up front.
We have all sides, defense, number 90, 5-yard penalty.
So now it's third and one for FAMU, much more manageable than third and six, and for an offense that struggled to move the ball, this certainly helps.
Yeah, you know, if you've got an offense that's clicking on all cylinders, you can kind of throw the whole playbook out there. But in this game, they cannot take any first down for granted. I think they've got to come out with their heavy package and try and pound the ball forward for the first down.
We're seeing the jumbo set to give right up the middle. And does Page have enough for a first down? He does.
You know, and that's one there where that's a direct reflection of what happened the previous time they had third and short, and they left somebody unblocked. Well, what did they do? Offensive coordinator Lawrence Kershaw took it out of the offensive line's hands. You guys just move forward, and we'll muscle the ball through for the first down.
Here's McBurse on first down. Trying to get out of the backfield, and he can't. Good pursuit there by Hampton.
You know, trying to run into that short side boundary. And, you know, most times when you see that play, they only get away with it if a team is schematically out of place. You're not going to outrun an aggressive Pirate defense, especially one that's had this type of success, as you see there.
Third in the FCS a year ago. And remember, they had a kid on their D-line who we saw in person last year, Kenrick Ellis. He was a guy racking up double-digit tackles as a defensive tackle.
Right in the middle of the football field, getting 10 tackles per game. And he was rewarded for his efforts, drafted to the NFL.
Third-round pick of the Jets. Trainer finds his receiver at the 39-yard line. That's Lenworth Lennon. It was Lennon who saved the day in the season opener for FAMU.
And here you'll see he gets the ball because a nice pocket. Nobody around Trainer, able to scan the field and hit Lennon coming across the formation.
Go back to that season opener against Fort Valley State. Late in the game, Trainer throws one downfield, hits off a receiver's helmet, and Lennon happens to be right place, right time. Third and short. It's Page up the middle. He might be a little short here.
Now that's a formation there where you see where they can continue to do that smash mouth anytime they get third and 1 or 2 yards because they don't have Kenrick Ellis. See, if Kenrick Ellis was there playing for the Pirates this season, he'd stand them all up and be a big pile behind the line of scrimmage. But they're a little bit small on the defensive line this year. I mean, you've got, they replaced Ellis, who weighed 360 pounds, with Ian Davidson, who's 6'4", 305 pounds. So a little bit less mass on the defensive line for Hampton.
That short run by Page was good enough for a first. Ball now at the 41. Play action. Trainer hit as he throws it. And it looks to be complete to Kevin Elliott, his first catch of the game. Now this season, a new wrinkle for televised FCS games. We do have replay, and the same rules apply. You can review every play. And
oh,
boy, it was signal to catch, but that is clearly not a completion.
Yeah, that ball hit the turf there.
And they can review this now.
And they see it on the Jumbotron. You wonder what the delay is. And unfortunately for Florida A&M, as you mentioned, we do have replay in the MEAC conference as one of the first.
For the previous play is a completed pass. That play is under review.
Yeah, again, there was no instant replay review in the FCS a year ago. The rule this year, if the game is on TV, if it is a televised game, officials do have the luxury of looking at a play, and the same rules apply that are in the FBS, which is, or rather, in the MEAC, which is you can review a play. You can review basically any play.
Yeah, but I think that's smart. And reasons like this, you know, ultimately as a football player, even as a fan, you want them to get the call right. And this is one that was called a catch. And instead, it looks like it's going to be overturned. You see the ball here is going to hit the turf. Elliott does a good job of trying to get his hands underneath. But I don't think he does. And I think this ball will be overturned. And, you know, the only time you had instant replay before in the FCS level was in the postseason. They did
yes.
it for postseason. The MEAC has been one of those conferences that has always been kind of cutting edge. They were the very first collegiate conference, period,
right,
that had the official
announced the number. It's a televised MEAC game, to clarify.
Yes, but I remember when Johnny Greer was the head of the officials coming from the NFL, he said, we don't want any more of that holding on the offense. We want holding number 72 in white, and then after they started in college football, now that's the norm throughout college football.
So give this credit. Play likely comes back.
Yeah, so give credit to Commissioner Thomas, the commissioner of the MEAC Conference, of being cutting edge, trying to stay ahead of the curve. And if you've got a niche Schroff in town with all of his TV cameras and crew there, why not use the technology to make sure the calls are done right?
Hey, you're the rock star wherever we go. Howard's Jay Walker.
Okay, franchise.
After review, the pass is incomplete. It'll be second down. Ball's on the 41-yard line.
It served its purpose, and that's what it's there for.
Yeah, got it done in about a minute and 30 seconds from the time that the whistle blew. So, not bad. And unfortunately for Joe Taylor, this is 2011, not 2010, so your offensive woes aren't being helped at all.
By the way, FAMU with the ball at its 41-yard line here on second and 10. It's the first time all game they've crossed their own 40. Forget about midfield. Still 10 yards away from that. Lennon in motion. That's Brian Timms. Takes the big hit and gets 9 yards. He's going to be very close to a first down.
And that's a good job there by Trainer of knowing where to go with the football. You've got one-on-one coverage on the outside. You've got a slant route. The inside linebacker's too close to the line of scrimmage. Go ahead and get the ball to your outside receiver. Brian Timms with the one-on-one with the cornerback playing 10 yards off. Almost able to pick up the first down.
They're going to measure here to see if FAMU picked up the first down. Ball right at midfield, so about three quarters of the ball over midfield, so FAMU technically in Hampton territory for the first time.
Yeah, they're moving now, and they're getting the offensive production up. Loosened them up with a couple throws or the threat of the pass and picked up a first down.
They got it.
First down for the Rattlers.
So first down and into Hampton territory. This is far and away been the best drive FAMU has put together so far.
And when you've got a team that's trying to wear you out, it's crucial that your offense pick up a couple first downs. You know, Nish, we go around the country, we see the different games in the FCS level, and I think we've come up with something we got to start tracking. Impact transfers, guys that weren't on campus a season ago but are playing for you now. For Florida A&M, it's linebacker Kevin Nelson, transfer from the University of Miami, and we've called the name of Al Tariq McBurst several times, the explosive running back from Purdue, who Joe Taylor and the whole coaching staff just kind of gushed about when they saw him, didn't they?
Their eyes lit up. Trainer has time, throws, completes to Eddie Rocker, his tailback, and Rocker with a first down. Justin Blake finally forced him down, but not before a 15-yard gain.
And we talked about the pocket, winning the line of scrimmage. Look at this. Nobody gets close to a Trainer. He's able to pull that ball down three times before he found the open receiver on the outside and got the ball to Rocker. Rocker doing a good job squaring up his shoulders, getting parallel, and delivering a lick on Justin Blake coming over there with the high shoulder pad level.
10th play of the drive. Trainer with time, going deep, and that's going to be pass interference or holding. One or the other, number 21, it's going to be pass interference. Courtney Bridget, you saw his hands all over the jersey of Brian Timms.
You know, the pre-snap read said the middle of the field is open, and that's the case you go for. Which my wide receiver is going to be in the middle field, my best matchup. And good job by Trainer of recognizing the weakness of the defense and attacking it. He didn't come away with the completed pass, but he went to where he was supposed to go with the football. And it looks like he's going to be rewarded with pass interference on Courtney Bridget.
We have Holdy, number 21 on the defense. 10-yard penalty, automatic, first down.
So it's a holding call. You knew it was going to be one or the other, and they go with holding. So it's a 10-yard penalty instead of a 15-yard one.
Yeah, and he's got a whole handful of jersey right there, slowing him down in stride. And hey, that's that chase position, you know, and actually,
that's,
you know,
close.
Defensive backs are taught, hey, when you get beaten, there's no help deep in the middle, grab them, tackle them, do what you must do. Don't give up the touchdown.
8th penalty, by the way, on Hampton. Trainer throws again, and again, it's Timms. Near sideline, inside the 25-yard line.
You know, they're starting to attack that left side of the field where Bridget's playing cornerback. And the one thing about Bridget, he's a transfer from UNLV.
Big
great
guy.
Size, 6'4" tall. But that's twice they've picked on him. Once he got the pass interference in that last pass attempt, missed a tackle in the open field.
Well, they've got him matched up with Timms, and Timms is their speed guy going up against the big physical corner.
So what do you do? What neutralizes size, Anish?
Speed.
Trainer again, another quick out. This is McBurse. And it's McBurse, close to another first down. Let's check in with Mike Leeson.
Anish, Justin Blackman has 13 straight 100-yard receiving games. That's an NCAA record. Perry scores for Oklahoma State, only 3 yards, but Brandon Whedon says, hey, I'll take it. That's his 4th touchdown pass of the year. 14-0 Cowboys over the Wildcats.
All right, thank you, Mike. Oklahoma State, Arizona. We expect a shootout over there with Nick Foles.
It's just a matter of time before Nick Foles gets it going.
3rd down and 2 from the 17. And a flag.
That's flag on the play.
Start. Number 76, Blake. 5-yard penalty. Replay to down.
They got the junior, Steven Robinson, Central Florida transfer. So now 3rd and 2 becomes 3rd and 7. And they were having success on 3rd and short. 3rd and 7, not so much so far against Hampton.
You know, when you've got 3rd and 1 to 2 yards, if you don't get it, then you can contemplate going for it on 4th down. But right now, very important that they get some good yardage on this 3rd down play.
They've got to get to the 15. Trainer throws. He's got Lennon over the middle. 1st and goal, FAMU.
He threw a bullet.
Make that Brian Timms with the catch.
good job by Timms running the skinny post here on the right side of your screen, and you'll see Trainer lock in on him, and Timms did a good job of keeping his body in front of the defensive back to square up and make that catch in his hands.
Austin Trainer, after the slow start, 7 for his last 8. First and goal from the 1.
Got
Trainer,
him.
Rollout, wide open, he's got his tight end. Michael Etheridge, and he dropped it, he could not hold on.
Oh, wow.
Well, what did the coaching staff tell us about Etheridge?
He's the
freshman, he's the blocking tight end, his hands are a work in progress.
Great play action, good job of squaring your shoulders, throwing to the left. Oh, he's got to come down with that ball.
Looks like he had it.
He left his feet when he didn't have to. Bad things happen when you leave your feet for no reason at all. Oh, Michael Etheridge, you had an opportunity to make this game close.
Second and goal. Now Trainer in trouble, throws in the end zone. A flag on the play. Boy, they went with what seemed like the identical play.
Yeah, they did, and this time the Pirates made the adjustment, but linebacker Delbert Tyler got stuck behind the second read.
Call me crazy here, Jay. You've got the ball at the 1 yard line. Why not just punch it in?
I think they will now. I think the lessons learned after that last play, but Etheridge was so wide open that first time with the great play action.
This is likely.
We have pass interference. Number 34, blue. Half the distance to the goal. Automatic first down.
So the ball moves, what, about
6 inches?
Yeah.
6.5 inches, something like that. And now should be the time they muscle it in, Nish.
On first and goal. Here's Page into the end zone. FAMU is on the board.
After touchdown for the Rattlers.
Well, you wanted the power running game, Anish. They drew it up for you there. They got the first down and decided to load it up. And normally you see runs like that. You just follow the fullback. You'll see a collision. Good job there by the Florida A&M offense to punch it in.
Page actually broke a couple of tackles to get in. Shed Lindell Gibson and Justin Blake. So FAMU, 14 plays, 81 yards. They chew up 7:14 on the clock. And a chance to make it a 3-point game here is now they're trying to get everyone on the field. Play clock running down to 5, to 4. And a flag. So a penalty before Trevor Scott could kick it.
Offside defense, number 6, half a distance to the goal. Retry.
So now the ball moves up to the 1 yard line. You still kick here though, right, Jay?
I think so. I mean, that's what the card says. You know, all the coaches carry the cards. If you're down by this, you do that. And the card still says down by 4, take the extra point attempt.
Especially this early. Trevor Scott boots it through. Florida A&M has made it a 1-possession game. It's Levante Page, a 1-yard touchdown run. The Rattlers right back in it. ESPNU's College Football Primetime brought to you by Progressive, making it easy to buy car insurance. And by New Balance, let's make excellent happen. Hampton leads FAMU 10-7, second quarter. Hampton scored the first 10 points. FAMU just capping a 14-play, 81-yard drive with a Levante Page 1-yard touchdown run. That's where we stand here. It's 10-7 with Jay Walker. Anish Shroff, home opener for the Pirates here at Armstrong Stadium on this gorgeous Thursday evening. FAMU to kick it off. Antoine Chisholm bobbles it. He's going to run it out of the end zone. And he's tackled at the 1 yard line. Hampton will start from the shadow of its own goalpost when we come back. 10-7 to score. Big news in black college football. We'll get you all updated when we come back.
Saturday. Heisman hopeful Andrew Luck leads the charge for the Stanford offense against the Blue Devils of Duke. And New Mexico travels to Razorback Country for a date with Arkansas. College football lives here every day on ESPNU, Saturday at 3:30 and 7.
Yulee battles Buford tomorrow at 8:30 on ESPNU.
Look down. It's high time to make our floor look better and feel softer. How about we start with the guaranteed low price on the carpet, the pad, and installation? Let's get peace of mind for a lifetime. It all adds up to better carpet at a better price and a great-looking room transformed. More saving, more doing. That's the power of the Home Depot.
Welcome back to Hampton, Virginia, where it's the hometown Pirates leading Florida A&M 10-7. Alongside former Howard quarterback Jay Walker, I'm Anish Shroff. You're watching Thursday Night Football here on ESPNU. Really, this game, a tale of two quarters. Hampton dominated the first quarter. FAMU so far dominating the second.
I mean, consider what we were looking at in the first quarter. You would have thought that Hampton was going to run away with this one. Florida A&M got their act together, and to the big grin of Coach Donovan Rose for Hampton, his team is only up by 3 points after a dominating first quarter performance, and they're up against the ropes right now.
I mean, this is a big matchup, and not only the MEAC, but in the HBCU. And looking at some of the other notes and news from Black College Football, Doug Williams returning to Grambling.
That's big news.
Big hire.
And you know who
the
starting quarterback is for Grambling State? Doug Williams. His son, DJ, is starting. They got a big victory over Alcorn State last week. And the MEAC Conference, welcome aboard. They've expanded. They've added North Carolina Central and Savannah State, officially expanding the conference to 11 teams. And then the number one team in the polls right now, the Bulldogs of South Carolina State.
David Legree throwing on first down. It's incomplete, intended for Hicks. So the ball on the 1 yard line, and Hampton throwing on first down.
Yeah, six sacks, getting Legree a time to figure out where behind the rattle. Like that.
Oof. Boy. Intended for somebody, Javaris Brown, and you thought it was
levels. Defensive coordinator feed every time the bottom with it off.
It brings Jay Folsen in coverage, and Legree hit him in the numbers.
Legree's got a strong arm, but at a certain point, you can't use that strong arm on every throw. You've got to become a passer at times, and everything we've seen from him has been fastball, fastball, fastball.
Now, Jay Hampton, they want more aggressive play calling offensively, but from the 1 yard line, three consecutive passing plays. What do you make of that?
Well, they have the confidence in their offense to get rid of the ball, and they were really relying upon Legree's decision making. They just weren't able to convert.
Jarrell Stewart fields inside his own 45 for FAMU. Into Hampton territory, across the 40, spun down at the 38 yard line. 18-yard return on the punt, and FAMU set up with great field position. Now, the FAMU community is dealing with heavy hearts after the death of one of its student athletes earlier this week. Shannon Washington was a guard on the Rattlers women's basketball team. She was fatally stabbed in her apartment during a fight with an out-of-town friend over Labor Day weekend. Tallahassee police have charged Starquinicia Palmer with first-degree murder. FAMU held a vigil on campus Sunday night in Washington's honor. Of course, our thoughts and prayers go out to the Florida A&M community. 2011 Pirate football team.
There are many vehicles that claim to be just as capable off-road as the Jeep Grand Cherokee. But without triple-sealed doors, a raised air intake system, or even a watertight drivetrain, just how far off-road are they talking about?
I'm a ref being chased out of town after the worst game of my career. You forget one down and the whole stadium turns on you. And if you have credit rate insurance, it may not pay for all this. So get Allstate. You can save money and be better protected from mayhem, like me.
Shop less, get more. Make one call to an Allstate agent.
30,000 feet. The weather there is a sunny 66 degrees. We're looking good for an on-time arrival at about 5:45 local.
An airline's job is to take you from where you are
to where you need to be. And we're not just talking about points on a map. It's about constantly finding new ways to make the world a smaller place and close the gap between far away and right away. Like having the most Wi-Fi equipped planes that let you venture beyond our more than 200 U.S. destinations to be everywhere at once. Like a more intuitive Delta website and mobile app that can connect you to information about your next flight even while you're still in flight. Innovations like these are extending our reach so that you can extend yours. And now, even at 30,000 feet, you can still touch the ground.
Mike Leeson back in the ESPNU studios. Coming up on the State Farm, a halftime report. Number 9, Oklahoma State and Arizona go at it today. And we'll have the latest on Texas A&M, their attempted move to the SEC. Notre Dame heads for the Big House. Michigan hopes they have the defense to go to 2-0.
All right, thank you very much, Mike. With Jay Walker and Ish Raff here. Tweet, 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 tweet. At Armstrong Stadium. And yes, Twitter, social media. You just joined Twitter. Jay Walker, ESPN. Follow him. Our question to you, who will win the MEAC title this season? Something that we may have a better gauge of after the weekend, considering the teams that were picked in the top four all playing this weekend. FAMU, Hampton, and then Saturday you got Bethune-Cookman and South Carolina State.
See, and that's why we're asking the fans the answer now. We're right. Not letting them answer on Monday.
So we can say we told you so on Monday.
Exactly,
I get it. Trainer going long on first down, and it's intercepted. James Butts, the senior, coming down with it. And the second turnover of the game for FAMU.
And that's one of those turnovers that you hate as an offensive coordinator, because he had two wide receivers running wide open underneath the coverage. You're going to see one come right across the screen. He's got his man beat, but he decided to go deep down the field. James Butts playing center field, showing his range and athleticism, coming down with it. You know, they call Butts the old man of the secondary. Yeah. This is a guy that's overcome two knee injuries, well respected in that secondary, showing you for a guy with two knee injuries, he's still got some range playing that free safety position.
Trainer was looking for his running back, Eddie Rocker, there downfield. And instead it's Hampton ball, but for the second straight possession, Hampton starting inside its own 10-yard line.
Yeah, so now this is one where you really put your offense in a bind. I mean, your defense in a bind. Now they came out there, they got the three and out last time. Now you're asking them to do it again against an explosive offense.
Javaris Brown sheds one tackler. Gets close to the 15-yard line, gain of 5 yards.
Now with a little breathing room, you can tell that Hampton's going to try and get it back going again, find their rhythm they had. I think what really derailed them was that long drive by Florida A&M.
Here's McCain, stays on his feet across the 20. He's got a first down. And Hampton moves the sticks with 4:38 to go.
And that was a real game-changing interception thrown by Trainer. All the momentum was out. You see the good individual effort here by McCain to make the first guy miss and then pick up some extra yards after contact.
Here's Chisholm. He's been quiet in this game and struggles just to get back to the line of scrimmage on first down.
And the one thing for Florida A&M, they've been able to hang their hat on, the defensive line, very impressive group. This is a 3-4 scheme with Jerry Willis and Nick Hollinghead and Brandon Davis. Those three down linemen are having their way, clogging up holes against the Pirate offense.
On second and 7, another quick out, and this time some space for McCain. He's across midfield. Cuts back to the middle of the field, or tried to, and before that he's taken out of bounds at the 30-yard line.
Just the bubble screen with great wide receiver blocking, and Dyree McCain is a guy that the coaches said has really stepped up his senior year, showing you he had the ability to make a guy miss and get the big play for the Pirates.
47 yards on the pass and catch. And it's now first and 10 at the 23.
Yeah, quick look. He's just going to get rid of the ball on the outside. Look at that great blocking. Eye up the safety, make him miss, put him in trail position. And Big play for the Pirates.
Reginald Hicks calling for it at the bottom of your screen. Let's see if the three goes that way. There's Hicks, wide open, and into the end zone. Touchdown, Hampton.
Well, Anish, you saw it, and guess who else saw it? David Legree to go along with Reginald Hicks. Busted coverage there by the Pirates, by the Rattlers, excuse me. Ends up in a touchdown for Hampton.
There is a flag at the end of the play. Is this one of those excessive celebration penalties?
After the score, we have taunting. Number three on the off. That could be assessed on the kickoff.
That's something the officials are cracking down on this year. Taunting.
Yeah, you know, you're not allowed to interact with anybody. See, that's his fault right there. Yeah. You know, when we talk to the officials at their official meetings, that's a penalty. If you celebrate with anybody other than your teammates, you can't celebrate with the mascot, with a teacher that's there in the stands. You can only celebrate with your teammates, or else they're going to call that penalty on you. You know, another one of the changes you got to be aware of, if he gets another penalty like that in this game, he's ejected. They'll kick him out. So the rule is just celebrate. But let's take a look at that touchdown there and see what you have. Just nobody over there. The Florida A&M defense doesn't even recognize that he's on the field. He's the widest guy along the outside. Good job of getting the ball snapped and getting it into the end zone.
Yeah, before the play, Hicks was waving his arms as if to say, there's nobody covering me. And as soon as the ball was snapped, Legree went right to Hicks. And for Reginald Hicks, it's his second touchdown of the game. Had an 18-yard reception in the first quarter, a 23-yard reception here in the second. It's 17-7. And Hampton 14 points now off of the two FAMU turnovers.
And, you know, they're taking advantage of the turnovers, but this is his boundary corner. This is his job. He's got to look to see who the outside guy is, Marvin Ross. Ross started for them a season in the opening game, and you can tell this is Hicks right here on the very bottom of your screen. And you can see the cornerback, number 13. He doesn't see it.
Yeah.
Outside boundary.
Tough to see Hicks even on your screen there, but he was all the way at the bottom, and nobody was lined up on him. So 17-7 Hampton. That's a 92-yard drive, by the way. And they started at their own 8 after that interception by James Butts.
You know, and just look at what happened in comparison, where it looked like Florida A&M had the long, methodical drive down the field that they wanted. The defense got a 3-and-out, got the offense back on the field, but Hampton took advantage of the turnover with the quick strike.
Now remember, because of that taunting penalty, Hampton will kick off from its own 15-yard line. So FAMU should have decent field position here. Teron Durham to kick it off. Al-Tariq McBurse from his own 29. And he gets across the 45-yard line close to midfield. So good field position for FAMU. And don't forget, Saturday, we've got a full menu of the so-called bellwether cows in the MEAC Conference, the teams to beat in the MEAC.
I mean, in all of black college football as well, they're ranked number 1 and number 3, respectfully, in all of the black college polls. And then you're talking about teams that are ranked national. They got national implications. One team ranked number 23, the other ranked number 24. That's going to be a great game down in Daytona Beach, and I can't wait to get there to call the action.
Page tripped up for a loss, and looking at the Sheridan top 10, South Carolina State, they're number 1. Bethune-Cookman, though, with more first place votes. Hampton comes in at 8. Florida A&M did get 1 first place votes. And really, South Carolina State, Bethune, A&M, and Hampton, those are the 4 teams expected to contend for the MEAC title.
Yeah, and I think, you know, you got the top 2 teams, and as we talked about in the open, Florida A&M and Hampton are trying to figure out who's going to be the team that can win this game, that has the ability to upset one of those teams and maybe sneak into postseason play.
Second and 11. Trainer over the middle. He's got Timms. Timms just has nowhere to go. And it's third down and 11. No gain.
We saw Timms go hobbling off the field earlier, and you wonder the way he caught that ball. He was very timid at the end of that run there. Wasn't a very aggressive run after catch. You got to be wondering, is that injury still lingering a little bit in the back of his mind, or is he somewhere hurting?
Hampton has just used its first timeout here of the first half to stop the clock with 2:46 on third and 11. Don't forget, Saturday morning, ESPNU previews a full day of college football at 9 a.m. Eastern. Join Aaron Andrews and David's PNU for the latest on all things going on in college football, and certainly the storylines on the field and off the field have been plenty, especially with this Texas A&M situation over in the SEC, which seems to be changing by the day. Will they go? Won't they go? Who's going to hold them up? Who's not going to hold them up?
You and I, we differ on that one. You know, you think, hey, they've got to start doing this talk now. I think, can't this wait till the offseason? I mean, if we're talking about football moves, because they're not being made for basketball reasons, why can't they wait till the offseason? Let the kids enjoy their year. Don't have the coaches have all these other things to talk about.
FAMU trying to enjoy this drive a little longer on third down and long. Trainer overshoots his man. Good coverage by Hampton. And it'll bring up fourth down. So Hampton with 2:41. We saw how quickly they can score. This isn't the same offense from last year.
No
huddle. They can get up the field. 2:41 is an eternity for them now.
That's an eternity. And the woes for Florida A&M. Great field position. They gave up the touchdown, but they started off that drive with fantastic field position at midfield and couldn't even cross midfield. This Pirate defense is really stymieing the Rattlers.
Cambrell McGee lets it bounce, and it's going to be down deep in Hampton territory. So Hampton, for the third straight drive, will start inside its own 10-yard line. Our clock shows 2:19. The stadium clock shows 2:31. 17-7 Hampton. We talked about the transfers and their impact at the FCS level and in the MEAC. Hampton had a great impact transfer last year in Kenrick Ellis. They got a couple this year as well.
Yeah, you've got Jamal Wilson, the starting left tackle. He transferred from Rutgers. And then on defense, oh, who's that linebacker wearing number 4 we've seen running all over the field?
Lindell Gibson. We've called his name a few times tonight. A
few times. Good as advertised. Making an impact playing that middle linebacker position. You know, Gibson's a guy that started 11 games plus the bowl last season for Virginia Tech, so he's a bona fide football player.
Legree for McCain, and he's going to lose 2 yards, so Hampton was at its own 4, now at its own 2-yard line, and FAMU calling timeout.
And this is that part of the field where we saw earlier.
No, I'm sorry, FAMU is not called timeout.
We saw that defensive coordinator Earl Holmes was not afraid to bring pressure down here when he had a team against the ropes.
Here's Legree, steps out of his own end zone, throws. He's got a first down at the 23-yard line. That was an absolute bullet into the hands of Dyree McCain.
You can call 18-yard comeback curls when you've got a pitcher on the mound that can deliver fastballs effectively in the strike zone. I know it's a baseball analogy, but he's got the ability to get that wind up and really step into his throws, and that ball covered a lot of ground in a hurry.
Another completion. It's Isaiah Thomas on the far sideline. He gets out of bounds to stop the clock with 1:50 to go. And this Hampton offense with new offensive coordinator Willie Snead, it's built for a 2-minute drill. In fact, this is the regular offense. It's not really much of a deviation.
And this is Snead's first college football game as an offensive coordinator. You know, he was coaching high school football last season, and they felt comfortable in bringing him in here and allowing him to be the offensive coordinator, which is a huge step up from high school to college football.
Legree pumps, throws, picked off. Intercepted by Terry Johnson.
You know, if you're going to continue just throw every ball with a low line drive, then you've got to put some arc on that ball there. There's an opening on the outside, underthrown ball. Allow Terry Johnson, who was beat off the line of scrimmage, to get back in the play. And that's one of those balls where we like to say throw it firm but with an arc into that seam between the safety and the cornerback. Legree tried to drill it in there, threw it behind him. Interception.
So first turnover of the game for Hampton, and now FAMU starts at the Hampton 46-yard line with 1:44 to go, and they've got all three timeouts. They'll keep it on the ground. A little bit of a delay, and up to about the 44-yard line is FAMU.
And that's one there where Coach Taylor is trying to see if the offense can get things going, if they can find some help for their quarterback after throwing the interception. Trainer, starting in this contest, hasn't been as sharp as you would like. They're just trying to see if they can maybe get the running game established still.
Trainer throwing and completes to Kevin Elliott. The defender, Cambrell McGee, was draped all over him, but Elliott still makes the catch.
And that's a matchup they like to have. Kevin Elliott's a big wide receiver, Florida A&M, 6'3". Good job looking that ball in there and coming down with the catch.
Third and short. Trainer throwing incomplete. Lennon, the intended receiver. And now a decision for Joe Taylor on fourth down. It looks like the offense is going to stay on the field.
At this point, they got the turnover.
You're looking at about a 55-yard field goal if you decide to go that route. Or you can kick it. FAMU wants to talk it over. They'll take their first time out here in the second half. Jay, 38-yard line, fourth and two, down 10 points. You're Joe Taylor. What do you do?
I think you try and spread them out. You know, go with four or five wide receivers and do what they call choice routes. That's when you've got each wide receiver has the opportunity to curl in or curl out. Find a soft spot in the zone coverage, you anticipate zone. If they come up and play as some type of press coverage man-to-man, then you go for the home run shot over the top, try and get the big play. But it's all that is based on pre-snap read. In order to call this type of play, you've got to have a quarterback that's really good at studying his keys, learning where the defense is, and knowing what to anticipate when we go and spread them out with our offensive play. Where's the weakness going to be?
Now you could also try to draw Hampton offsides. The Pirates have been flagged for 10 penalties in this first half.
That could be the best play they could call, right, Anish? So they're playing zone coverage. If they can just get some guys to do some good choice routes, it should be open.
He's got Timms, and it's a first down.
Well, that shows you the personality there. At that point in the game, Hampton was willing to apply some pressure but not completely sell out. They came out in a soft zone coverage. They were going to give up anything but the deep ball.
So first and 10, ball on the 33. Trainer will tuck it and run. They give him the middle of the field, and he gets to about the 29-yard line. And another timeout by FAMU. So FAMU stops the clock with 28 seconds to go here in the first half.
This is where you want to make sure that the quarterback is managing the game properly. You know, you've got a quarterback in there, first time as your full-time starter through for a whole season, so you want to make sure the trainer realizes the situation. We can't afford an interception. The very least, let's try and pick up 10 more yards where we can get a field goal, and if we're able to score just a field goal, we're only down by one score.
Right now, they're looking at about a 46-yarder. Trevor Scott, the kicker, last year, his season long was 47. He was perfect last year from inside 40, 2 for 4 from 40 to 49, and didn't connect from beyond 50. So they're sort of at the outskirts of their kicker's range right now. Trainer, plenty of time. Again, he'll run. Takes a big
fumble.
Hit. The ball comes loose. Ball still on the ground. Still loose. It's still loose.
It's still loose.
And FAMU might
it's
have
still
it.
Loose.
It's still
out of
loose
bounds.
And it goes out of bounds. Unbelievable.
Oh, my.
There's 10 seconds left on the clock. Donovan Rose probably screaming, just fall on it. Trainer coughs it up.
Don't take on the linebacker. Get down, son. And you see Hampton, too many guys trying to get to the ball. Florida A&M has a chance. And then watch it just squirt out.
Yeah.
They're going for a power. The ball's not in there.
This was like a rugby play.
The ball's up, and watch everybody fall on the pile, and the ball is out.
We might be seeing that Friday on the Not Top 10.
It got kicked by Trainer's foot. They don't realize it. They're all fighting for it. Missed opportunity by both teams to recover the football.
So FAMU ball from its own 15-yard line with 10 seconds to go, and another whistle.
Wow.
Now, you technically can't advance the ball on a fumble, so it's wherever Trainer was down.
And I think that may be the discussion that you have right now.
And they can review where they want to spot the ball. Nobody ever had possession of the ball once Trainer coughed it up. Let's listen to Preston Harding. And now Harding trying to get the attention of the line judge.
The ruling on the field was a fumble, and it went out of bounds, and it stayed in possession of the offense. That play is being challenged by the Hampton coach.
I don't know if he's challenging the actual fumble. I think he's challenging
the spot
of the ball.
So the officials will look at the play again. You can't advance the ball on a fumble if it goes out of bounds and it never changed possession. So let's take another look.
Yeah, let's take a look and see where we anticipate the ball coming out. Right there, let's call it somewhere on that
27-yard line
right there is where the ball should come back. And then you'll see the ball get a big kick up the field and continue to come out. And right now they've got them spotted on the field on about the 12, at the 15-yard line. So
the ball went out of bounds at the 15-yard line, but it never actually changed possession. So you would think that they would spot it at the 27.
Yeah, can't advance it. Doesn't matter. You know, they came up with that rule in the NFL and for football after the Ken Stabler play.
Right.
You know, that was the one where they kind of changed the rule. Offense cannot advance the ball after that fumble. If they don't overturn this, that would be a great game. Talking about picking up an extra 12 yards. But look at the play here. This is one where, you know, right there, cover with two hands. You know, you don't make a living taking on linebackers. So that's one where you've got to cover that football up and compounding the mistake, the Hampton defense. Just get down on it.
Take one more look.
See, that's the hit there. That puts them squarely on the 27. Call it 28-yard line if you must, at the very least. That football is not round. That's why it doesn't always bounce the way you think it will.
Still reviewing the play. 10 seconds left. If you're Joe Taylor now, you're going to get the ball one way or the other. With 10 seconds left, ball at the 15, ball at the 27. What's the call with 10 seconds?
Well, I think they tried to call during the last timeout, and it's control the clock. The one thing you can't afford to do is have a turnover. Now, if you do get the ball in the 15-yard line, you can take a shot at the end zone for one play, try and get a one-on-one matchup.
After review, we had a forward fumbled out of bounds starting at the 27-yard line. The ball is returned to the 27-yard line. It is third down and 5, Florida A&M.
So, I mean, you know,
you can't advance the ball on a fumble.
Yep, and like we talked about earlier, the key is getting it right. You know, I would just want the kids, nobody to be shortchanged, and if the technology is there to make sure that we get the call right, then that's a good usage of the replay there good job by Coach Donovan Rose to call the challenge, to ask for a challenge just on the spot alone.
Right, and you have to remember, for a fumble, because the fumble went forward, that's why the ball moves backward. If it's a backwards fumble and it goes out of bounds, then wherever it goes out of bounds, that's where the team in possession would retain the ball. Instead, third and five from the 27, 10 seconds left.
Well, they can take a deep shot down here on the bottom.
They have one timeout.
If they'd like to. They've got a one-on-one matchup on the outside. Timms against Bridget.
Trainer. He's going for it all.
That's where it was going.
And it's incomplete along that near sideline. And the clock is still running. The clock was running. And wait a minute.
Don't go
anywhere. Wait a minute. That play did not take 10 seconds. So I guess we call this clockage, right?
Yeah.
So now some mass confusion on the field. You've got Hampton players trying to make their way to the locker room. And the officials trying to figure out why the clock was running.
Yeah, and I think that what the argument's going to be is they started running the clock before the snap. And so that's going to be what the argument was about there. And they actually
And they're going to say that's the end of the first half, so we'll go into the locker room.
No, you just heard it over
the PA. I'm not sure you can do that.
Yeah.
And right now, Hampton, their coach is waving the players back on the field. There's still time left on the clock. Preston Harding trying to assess the situation here at Armstrong Stadium.
Was it the half expired on that play? That play is under review.
So they're reviewing whether time expired. This is getting almost absurd at this point. We saw the clock start to run off before the play ever started, and it continued to run after the ball was ruled incomplete, and that play didn't take 10 seconds.
And you've got to know, you know, down on the field, the type of play that was called and the way the play progressed, it definitely wasn't a 10-second play. So if the officials started the clock when they weren't supposed to, that's something they've got to acknowledge right there. But you've got to have a football IQ and a good sense to know.
Last couple of moments here have not exactly been banner moments for the officials.
After review, please reset the game clock to 7 seconds. It is fourth down on the 27-yard line, Florida A&M.
Crowd doesn't like it, but it's the right call. So hang on. Mike Leeson in studio getting ready to do halftime. Not so fast, my friend.
And we're saying it again. You know, the delays and everything, that's one thing. But at the end of the day, we just want them to get it right, and they're getting it right.
Trevor Scott on to kick a 44-yard field goal. Again, his long last year, 47. And now FAMU will use its final timeout here in the first half.
Charge to the Rattlers.
But Joe Taylor still wants to talk things over with his team. Well, we have a moment. We remind you, we've got a full slate of college football this Saturday on ESPNU. It all gets going at noon Eastern with Central Michigan and Kentucky at 3:30 Eastern. Sixth-ranked Stanford and Andrew Luck going to Durham to take on Duke. At 7 Eastern, New Mexico and Arkansas go at it. And then at 10:30 Eastern, the two teams many believe are the two teams to beat in the MEAC, South Carolina State and Bethune-Cookman. You called Bethune's game against Prairie View A&M in the MEAC SWAC Challenge, and boy, were they impressive.
Dominating performance. That's Bethune's quarterback, the transfer from the University of Maryland, Jamar Robinson. He's coming there, established himself as a starting quarterback. He was the MVP of that MEAC SWAC Challenge, and they had a defense that simply punished Prairie View A&M all night. Bethune-Cookman's one of the most feared teams in the land.
Brian Jenkins has done a terrific job down at Daytona Beach. And another whistle.
Now, this is a little bit of the teacher and the
gamesmanship.
Student. Yes.
Timeout Hampton. Freeze the kicker.
You know, Donovan Rose was on Joe Taylor's staff for over a decade. So he said, I learned a couple things from Coach Taylor as well. You want to call the timeout to make sure your kicker's set? Well, let me call a timeout to freeze him a little bit. Let him think about this kick a little bit more.
Donovan Rose has spent more than two decades affiliated with this Hampton program, played for the Pirates, was an assistant coach. Actually, his first year as an assistant was the year before Joe Taylor came to Hampton. And then he was the only assistant that Taylor kept when Taylor brought his staff. Taylor had Rose under his wing for a long time. And then once Taylor went to FAMU, it was 1 year of transition. And then Donovan Rose took over. And this is his third season as the head coach. Trevor Scott, 44-yard field goal coming up for FAMU. Finally.
He's got another timeout. If you're Hampton, do you use it? Hey. And I agree with that. You know, if you're going to call one, you got to call two if you've got it there.
Part of my summer reading, a book that was out, Scorecasting, kind of looks at some of the, I guess, accepted rules in sports. Does home field advantage exist? They mentioned freezing the kicker. Now, this is empirical evidence. Freezing the kicker really,
say the percentage doesn't work.
Really doesn't have that much of an effect as you would like to think.
Until your kicker misses that kick when he was froze.
Well, we can always second guess. We only remember the times it works. So neither team has any timeouts left. 44-yarder, Trevor Scott, kick is up.
Plenty of leg.
And it's good. Scott drills it from 44 yards.
Man.
Hey, don't go home just yet. There's still time on the clock.
You know what I'm saying, man, about Anish? That proves your theory right about freezing the kicker doesn't work. I hate it when you're right, when you scoop me like that.
17-10 to Jay. It happens often, so let's
easy.
Not, you know.
Easy franchise.
It's only your first game together.
You know, good hold. They got it down there, and nice follow through. Plenty of leg. He had room to spare on that one. And that's one where you take a mental note. The kicking game is starting to come around, so you start to know your kicker's got a little bit more leg if needed. Good job there, putting it through the uprights.
That's his first field goal of the year on his first field goal attempt. And I've lost count in terms of real time, but the last 10 seconds of this half, certainly it's been spread out.
And you go back to this, when you think about this game, dominating performance by Hampton in the first quarter. Florida A&M comes back, scores. Then they have the turnovers, and they lose all that momentum, but yet they find a way to put those 3 points on at the end of the half to make it a one-score game, and they're still in it, where on two occasions we've thought that the Hampton Pirates were going to run away with this football game.
Now, Jay, back deep, Reginald Dixon for Hampton. What did we hear about him in practice and his speed yesterday?
Well, it's notorious. He's the fastest guy in the country. He's got medals to prove it. One of the finalists in Jerome Mathis was, which I said, you've got to prove it to me.
That kick sails into and out of the end zone. Nobody touched it, so still 1 second left. And if Hampton wants to try something, they'll have a shot here. 80 yards to go.
Well, maybe put Dixon out there, let him just run 80 yards. Nobody can catch him, but I'm pretty sure Coach Taylor and the staff would know if he comes on the field.
When we were talking about his speed, and they said he's faster than James Mathis, our eyes
Jerome
rolled.
Mathis.
It was Jerome's Mathis. Mathis, sorry. Our eyes rolled a little bit, and we said, come on, really?
Yep. I mean, Jerome Mathis, quite simply, has been the fastest football player I've ever seen in cleats. Played here at Hampton University. I mean, I've seen Jerome Mathis outrun NFL teams by himself. He's that fast. And he was a track runner here at Hampton as well, and he came in second in the 200 meters. Well, Reggie Dixon's done the same thing, coming second in the 100 meters. He can fly as well, so maybe we'll get a chance to see his speed.
After the longest 10 seconds in the history of football, the first half comes to an end here at Armstrong Stadium. It's Hampton up by a touchdown, leading 17-10. We send it back into the studio now, and Mike Leeson.
Welcome to the State Farm Halftime Report.
Now that we've seen the longest 7 seconds of the college football season, maybe for the entire season, here's the play of the night so far. And I agree with Anish, this should wind up on SportsCenter's top 10. Somebody somebody jump on the football. You know, Hampton had three defensive players wind up in NFL camps. I guarantee you one of the three would have jumped on that football at one juncture.
The scary thing about that is that's basically the first or the last 10 seconds in a nutshell. That just lets you know what just happened in that game. That just happened.
And welcome to the State Farm Halftime Report. Mike Gleason with a couple of Pac-10 guys. We've got Jason Sehorn from USC. We've got Charles Arbuckle from UCLA, tight end, defensive back. We might have some bump and run going on here in the next 20 minutes. You know, I was going to ask you something about that last touchdown. But now that last 7 seconds took so long, I can't remember what I was going to ask you about the last.
I know we all lost our train of thought.
It was basically it's hard enough to play football without, you know, when you don't cover somebody. I mean, there was nobody on that receiver.
Yeah. I mean, he was wide open, but that got trumped by that last fumble. I mean, the ball just kept rolling. You couldn't fit. Who was going to pick the ball up? Jason knows, and we were just sitting here, fall on the ball, fall on the ball. It's the most simple thing you learn when you play Pop Warner football.
Hampton on top, 17-10 right now. Last year it was 17-12, the final score. Florida and AMU pulled out the victory. All right, Thursday night college action, ninth-ranked Oklahoma State and Arizona go at it. Nick Foles hoping to do better tonight than he did last year in the Alamo Bowl. Pick up the action, and first quarter, no score. Joseph Randall, big game last week, another big game today.
Talked about Kendall Hunter being gone, and this had to be the guy. He's showing you right away how well he can run. A 42-yard rush right off the bat helps establish this offense.
That set up the first touchdown, and here comes Whedon to Blackman.
Yeah, we're not going to hear that very many times this season. You know, the biggest question mark going in was basically how this offense was going to work under new offensive coordinator Todd Monken. So far in the first half of this game, it looks like it's working pretty well.
Let's take another look at the spin by Justin Blackman, last year's Biletnikoff winner. Great spin move there. Later, here comes Randall. 4-yard touchdown, another touchdown, his second. He had two last week when he went over 100 yards. So you take a look at, you know, Dana Holgorsen goes to West Virginia. They average 520 yards of offense, but obviously they haven't missed a beat this year.
And that was a big question for a lot of people, because you're asking Todd Monken to come in and run somebody else's offense, and whether or not he understood it like Dana Holgorsen did. Did he know how to call it? There's a rhythm to calling offensive plays. So far, I would say in the first couple of games, definitely the first half of this Arizona game, Todd Munkin's got it down.
Well, when you have a guy that has ballet-like skills but also can just make things like you just saw there, Justin Blackman, but you have to have a running game. And I think Kendall Hunter is the key weapon there. And the way he's running the football, 71 yards, two touchdowns, Joseph Randall, excuse me. But when Kendall Hunter leaves, that helps this offense. That's the thing they miss the most. Randall coming in, you didn't know what to expect. But for him to have two touchdowns against an Arizona team that thought they had a chance, even without Jerron Kreiner, I'm impressed.
Remember, an Arizona team built on defense.
Justin, yeah, exactly. Justin Blackman, too, 13 100-yard receiving games. He's got 6 for 66 already tonight. Well, Texas A&M more than likely will land in the SEC, but it might not be as soon as they'd hoped for. Dan Beebe, the Big 12 commissioner, did send Mike Slive, the SEC commissioner, a letter stating the Big 12 Board of Directors would not pursue any legal action against the Aggies or the SEC. But Beebe says he could not talk for the individual members of the league. Texas, Oklahoma, and now Texas Tech say they've all waived their rights to litigation, but that still leaves plenty of other schools who are willing to head to the courtroom to keep the Big 12 alive. The SEC has stated from day one that before they open the doors to the Aggies, there must not be any contractual hindrances to the departure. Now, if the Big 12 does implode, early indications have Oklahoma heading west to the Pac-12, which in time, of course, would become the Pac-16. And now Bob Stoops took it one step further, saying it could also be the end of the traditional Oklahoma-Texas rivalry.
I don't think it's necessary. I know no one wants to hear that, but if life changes, you know, if it changes, you got to change with it, to whatever degree. So if it works, great. I love the game, but if it doesn't, it doesn't. Sometimes, you know, that's the way it goes.
I've always been on record as saying I love traditions. I love rivalries. I think they're important to kids. They're important to fans. But in the situation right now we're looking at with realignment across the country, we've given everything up to Bill Powers and to Lost Dodds, because I'm trying to work with things I understand and I know, and that changes by the hour.
People find other rivalries. You find other fun places to go and enjoy the game, enjoy the experience. And I think it's obvious we'll always have a great product that'll be exciting to follow, and we always have great TV audiences. So whatever happens, we'll adjust to it.
Stick around after the game. We're going to discuss that no Texas-Oklahoma rivalry. Well, I'll leave it for after the game before I get my opinion. Right now, let's take a little tour on campus for some news and notes. You know, how long has the backup quarterback for the Colts walked around with a clipboard, probably didn't even know where his helmet was? Well, now Peyton Manning has additional surgery on his neck, and his timetable for return is still unclear. But the NFL and ESPN reached an agreement to keep Monday Night Football on the worldwide leader for another 8 seasons. And LSU receiver Russell Shepard has been cleared to rejoin the team on September 24th when the Tigers head for Morgantown to take on West Virginia. Coming up this weekend, two football powers. Neither can make up their minds on a number one quarterback. Alabama and Penn State keeping their fans hanging in the balance. And for the first time in Michigan history, the Maize and Blue will kick it in the big house under the lights. And they're going to do it against an angry Irish team looking for their first victory in 2011. Back with more of the State Farm Halftime Reports coming up right after this.
When you join together talented student athletes with great coaches at wonderful institutions of higher learning, you have all the resources you need to achieve success. The Mideastern Athletic Conference was established on the principles of educating and preparing student athletes for the game of life. Comprised of 13 outstanding institutions, the MEAC continues its tradition of athletic dominance on the playing field and academic success in the classroom. The Mideastern Athletic Conference, celebrating excellence.
Is your computer running slowly? Does it take more than 3 seconds for your email to load? Are you frustrated with error messages, blue screens, computer freezes and crashes? These are not only annoying, but can cause permanent damage to your computer. If you're experiencing any of these symptoms, your computer and your privacy may be at risk, because these are usually the telltale signs of a virus, and it can only get worse until you act. Get a free diagnosis at mycleanpc.com.
My Clean PC is outstanding, and my computer is running faster than ever.
My Clean PC came through with flying colors when no one else could.
My Clean PC totally cleaned up my system and increased my speed.
MyCleanPC.com can remove spyware, viruses, and infected emails, all speeding up your PC's performance. It offers all-in-one protection, and it's been downloaded by millions of users. Even if you have antivirus software, your computer could still be infected. Find out instantly with a free comprehensive diagnosis at mycleanpc.com.
The official training bike of the Tour de France, the ProForm TDF, the first ever indoor training bike that delivers everything you demand. A 20% incline and a 20% decline, so you'll experience exactly what the road does. Because it's powered by Google Maps, you choose the road and the TDF follows it. Every incline and decline, so no matter what comes at you, you'll be ready. The ProForm TDF automatically adjusts resistance, incline and decline. Plus, with a built-in power meter, you'll know your exact output. You decide where to go, and the official training bike of the Tour takes you there. And now that you've decided, we're ready to deliver. Order right now and get zero down and a free upgrade on rush shipping. Call the number on your screen or go online today.
This halftime report is presented by State Farm. For auto, home, life, and banking, get to a better state.
Raring to go for the second half, and I'm sure, well, hopefully there's not a 7 seconds in the second half as long as the first half. 17-10, Hampton, the Pirates, on top by a touchdown. Enjoy.
College football primetime presented by McDonald's. It's Hampton and FAMU. We're at the half. It is a 17-10 Hampton lead here at Armstrong Stadium. Home opener for the Pirates. Hampton scored the first 10 points of the game, jumping out to an early lead. FAMU came back, and then FAMU got a field goal before halftime after Hampton went up 17-7. Alongside former Howard quarterback Jay Walker, I'm Anish Shroff, and really it's been a game where momentum has shifted multiple times. It was Hampton that got off to the great start, and then FAMU in that second quarter, much more patient offensively and able to capitalize off some turnovers.
And I think it's really going to come down to is Hampton had an opportunity to put FAMU away early, but they did not take advantage of it. Florida A&M came out, had a miscue on special teams, and then you saw the interception, which took all the momentum. So when Hampton had them up against the ropes, they weren't able to put them away. We saw a big throw by David Legree. That's a pretty good pass. passing line right there. 16 to 24, 184 yards with two touchdowns, and he got the interception as well. But I think that's the story, is if you let a team hang around that you're thoroughly outplayed, sooner or later they'll come back and bite you.
Penalties killed Florida A&M in its first game, which they still won against Fort Valley State. They had 19 for 270 yards in that game. Hampton apparently taking a page out of Florida A&M in week one. Penalties have really hurt Hampton, 10 for 67, and a few of those have kept Rattler drives alive.
Yeah, I mean, the first two first downs that Florida A&M got this evening were by way of the penalty. So Coach Donovan Rose has to have the Pirates start playing more disciplined football, stop the mental errors, and cut down on the yellow flags.
Jay, neither team has really had success running the football in the first half. If that trend continues, who does this game favor?
Well, it definitely favors Hampton University, because they've got the type of spread out offense right there, and they've got a quarterback that's in command. He's a senior, he's got the leadership. And if you're Florida A&M, you want to be able to run the football, and they should be able to. That's the surprising thing to me. I really do believe that this Florida A&M offensive line is stronger than the undersized defensive line for Hampton, but speed of the defensive line for Hampton has been able to neutralize the power running for Florida A&M.
Hampton will receive to start the second half. The speedy Reginald Dixon and Antoine Chisholm back deep. This is going to be Chisholm from his own four. And he's tackled shy of the 20-yard line. We really haven't called Chisholm's name much tonight. He's the reigning MEAC Offensive Rookie of the Year.
Yeah, they've really done a good job of clogging it. I don't know if we will continue to. I think if Chisholm's going to have an impact in this game, it may be off of a screen or something of that nature, because the Florida A&M defense is doing a good job of clogging the middle. And quite frankly, with the three-man rush, they've been able to bottle in Chisholm, making it very tough for him to find running lanes.
So they spot the ball right at the 20-yard line, and that's where Hampton will start. David Legree, solid first half, two touchdown passes, throws here, completes to Reginald Hicks, and Hicks gets six.
Something unique I noticed that Hampton does that you normally don't see from teams that run the spread offense. Legree gets the snap, and he takes another three or four steps back. Most shotgun quarterbacks sit in the pocket, but watch Legree on the passing plays. He'll take another four-yard drop when the ball snapped, making it very difficult for them to get to him.
FAMU nearly jumped. Here's Chisholm fighting for yards, gets to the 30. He's going to be a yard short of the first down. Brandon Hepburn on the stop.
How special a running back is Antoine Chisholm? So special that Coach Donovan Rose makes him wear a red jersey in practice. Now, normally quarterbacks wear a red jersey, you don't touch them. They don't want you touching Chisholm, their running back. He means that much to this team.
Flag on the play as the throw goes toward the far sideline. You saw that come in right away.
Once again, Hampton doesn't seem to be helping themselves. And they call it the chop block there.
Norman Booker, number 55.
Chop block called against the Pirates.
Take a look at the left side of your screen. You'll see it right there. One guy's engaged, the center's engaged. They shouldn't have called on Booker. They should have called on the actual center, Vincent Harper. Booker was engaged high. Harper went low on him. You're not allowed to do that. If one guy's got contact up high, then you cannot take out the legs from underneath the defender.
So ball at the 15-yard line. Hampton has got to get to the 40-yard line for a first down. And another flag. Looks like we have some audio issues with the referee, Preston Harding's mic, but it's another penalty on Hampton. So now you're looking at first and 30 here. They got to get to Roanoke for a first down.
Now the key is just pick up some positive yardage on first down. You don't have to get it all back in one play. So often quarterbacks make that mistake of thinking they've got to go downfield right away. That's a fumble.
Instead, he goes down and he coughs it up, but Hampton recovers.
This drive is going in the wrong direction for Hampton, and it all started with the penalty. You'll see Legree get the snap. Now he's going to drop back another 4 yards, so he's pretty deep back there. He steps up, and good job by Joshua Newkirk dislodging Legree from the football, putting it on the turf to force the fumble.
So second and 35, ball at the 5 yard line. They've got to get to the 40 for a first down. Legree fakes to Chisholm, goes to McCain, and he gets pushed out of bounds near the 10 yard line, a gain of 5 yards on the play, and third down and very long coming up.
And we talked about the bubble screen during the break. You and I were talking off camera.
We saw a lot of bubble screens in that first half.
And that's by design. You know, I think their motto is, if we can have you chase down our wide receivers from sideline to sideline on a 2 yard gain, that's better than your defensive linemen, defensive ends not having to just stand in the middle and stuff the run. So they're doing it by design to get the play clock up there, the number count up there, trying to wear you down.
Third and 30, you're reading that right. Legree just dumps it off to Chisholm, makes a couple of moves, and he gets to about the 16-yard line. Joshua Newkirk finally gets to him. So fourth down coming up, and the punting unit on for Hampton. So a couple of penalties, a near fumble, and Hampton will kick it from its own 1 yard line. That's where their punter Jordan Stovall is standing. And Florida A&M, Jarrell Stewart, back at his own 40 yard line. And FAMU with a chance to get some good field position. Punt takes a bounce, and Hampton will down it in its own territory. So FAMU will start at the Hampton 49-yard line. And let's take a look at tonight's Bringing the Flavor, brought to you by McDonald's. That's McDonald's Bringing the Flavor, the Hampton Band, entertaining halftime show, little Kanye West in the repertoire.
Yeah, they mix it up pretty good. I like that choice of words. Very entertaining. Very entertaining. You know, I'm still coming off of seeing that Bethune-Cookman monster-sized band they've got.
How many tubas do they have again?
Bethune-Cookman had 29 tubas. How many did Hampton have tonight? Eight.
Al-Tariq McBurse. He busted through. That was like a trombone right up the middle.
And that's what they want to see from McBurse. You know, you talk about having a second gear. Watch him get this and accelerate through the line quickly. Cut to the outside and one arm tackle away from taking it to the house for a touchdown.
McBurse, the Purdue transfer. Coach is very high on this kid. He's a junior. Injured last week. He didn't play, but they said he's a running back that can do it all. And it's McBurse again. He's got a seam, makes a couple of guys miss, and he gets to the 20-yard line. Al-Tariq McBurse.
When you see I formation, follow the fullback. He's going to come through the gap, and McBurse is going to do it. Look at him seal that lane right there. McBurse is going to turn on the speed. He's got the safety in his eyes, and watch the cut to the outside. Oh, he cut back in. He would have had him. He would have had him had he stayed to the outside, but Ronald Jackson going in there, sealing the inside, giving McBurse room to get to daylight.
FAMU in the second half able to run the ball here. We haven't seen really neither team been able to run the ball successfully.
Follow the fullback again when he's in there, Jackson. They like to follow him.
This is Eddie Rocker out of the eye, right up the middle. And he's taken That's down fun. By Justin Blake.
Ronald Jackson's having fun right now. Get him in a three-point stance. He knows he's not going to get too many carries. So watch him just look for somebody to hit. Follow the fullback. Here he goes. Who's there? Just buckling. Lindell Gibson right there. And if you're Lindell Gibson, you've got to square up and take him on.
Well, Ronald Jackson, Jay, 6'2", 285. Yeah. I know Lindell Jackson's a former Virginia Tech guy, but you know, when 6'2", 285 is coming at you, that's offensive lineman weight right there.
I'm trying to say that'll test your football heart, won't it?
That will test your fortitude, yeah.
So he's in other things. Follow him again.
Second and short. I formation again.
Well, they gave it to 285.
This time they gave it to Jackson.
That's the reward right there. Second and one. See if he can just lean forward. It took five or six Pirate defenders to get him down.
And there's a flag at the end of the play.
It's a well put together 285 pounds, wouldn't you say?
That is a very tight package, if you will. built like a box. Box of bricks.
Oh, wow. And when they call the personal foul, neither team is doing their helping themselves out with the penalty, but look at him. He's just out there smiling. You know, he knows he should be playing offensive line for somebody. But, you know, he gets to get in that backfield. He's like, hey, I get a chance to hit some people.
Yeah.
Hey, he wants to do it. And, hey, at that big playing that fullback position,
not
that's not fair.
Not quite Fridge Perry, but we're talking maybe micro Fridge. And timeout Florida AMU, or Florida A&M, rather, with 9:42 to go here in this second quarter. It'll be second and 16, FAMU, when we come back.
For more than 30 years, the NCAA Division I Football Championship Subdivision has...
Florida A&M down 7, second and 16 from their own 25. Right now we take a look at tonight's Lex's playbook. Joe Taylor and the Rattlers finding the running game here in the second half, Jay Walker.
Well, that's what they want to do. And what do? They cheated and added the big fullback in there to assist with the running game. And that allowed Altariq McBurch an opportunity to have a lead blocker going in there. And he was able to change direction to get this running game on track.
When you look at their last game in the first half of this game, on their first 40 carries of the season as a team, Florida A&M, 42 total yards. It's been much better so far here in the second half. They'll throw here. Trainer finds Lennon. He's going to throw for Elliott. Incomplete. James Butts breaking it up in the end zone.
What do we say about James Butts earlier? What do they call him? The old man on the defensive secondary. He's a guy that's not going to make the mental error. So when you go with the double pass, you're hoping to get somebody to bite, not following their keys. Good job on the lateral. But you see, Butts wasn't fooled at all. Came over and attacked this ball. And Kevin Elliott did a good job of making sure that ball wasn't intercepted.
Not quite instant karma for Lennon. And instead, it's fourth down. And another field goal attempt. This one from 42 yards from Trevor Scott. He's already hit from 44 today. And this one is going to be wide. No good. So Scott misses from 42 yards. A missed opportunity for FAMU. And Hampton gets the ball back with 9:27 to go in the third.
And that's one there where we saw the look on Coach Taylor's face. He didn't have that confident look that I've seen Coach Taylor have before when talking about his special teams unit. And this here was just a bobble. There was a double clutch there and all defense to the kicker there. Once he's got that momentum going and he has to hesitate, then they tend to pull the ball as opposed to pushing the ball there. So that's one where they've got to get that snap back there with some rhythm, and the holder has to get it down too.
Well, you go back to that drive. I mean, it was second and one, and then you get that 15-yard penalty, that personal foul penalty, and all of a sudden you're thinking maybe seven to now you're kicking a field goal in excess of 40 yards.
Imagine the pressure they could have put on this Pirate team had they closed that gap to 4 points. You know, we talk about the aggressive nature of this Hampton offense, how they like to get a lot of plays called. Well, if you're in a tight football game, spread offenses tend to tighten up a little bit. Right now on the evening, this Hampton Pirate offense has run 46 offensive plays, so they're well on their way to getting that 80-plus plays they want to have in every football game.
They got two from Chisholm on the last one. Legree clutches, throws. He's got McCain, slips the tackler. First down and more, and it's Diaree McCain up to about the 43-yard line. Make that Isaiah Thomas on the catch.
Big time throw. Watch Legree. There's not going to be a good throwing lane here. He's got to sling this arm, slide. He's got to throw this ball sidearm just to get the attempt off. No throwing lane, but he knew where he was and found a way to get it to the receiver.
There's Javaris Brown, and he's into FAMU territory. Solid pickup on first down.
And then you see what they like to do. Once they see a defensive coverage that they like to attack. And take a look here at the sidearm throw. Guys in his way, no problem. He can just whip it out of there in a hurry and absorb the blow as well. Very difficult to do.
Legree, 6'4", 225. Started his college career at Syracuse, transferred to Hampton. And here's Legree right up the middle for a first down. And now Hampton inside the Florida A&M 45-yard line.
And start to look at the body language of the Florida A&M defense. The defensive linemen taking a little bit longer to get themselves up off the ground. Hampton is on attack right now, trying to press the action. The Florida A&M starts to seem as if they're getting a little bit winded, Anish.
This is Chisholm. And he gets to about the 40-yard line. 4 yards on the play. It'll bring up second down and 6.
And we were talking earlier how Chisholm was having a tough time getting going because the holes weren't so big. Well, now you've got a defense that's winded. Holes a little bit bigger, starting to open up, and Chisholm starting to find his groove.
4-yard pickup. Second down.
Antonio McLeod into the game. You saw Chisholm holding his shoulder after that last play. LeGree fakes to McLeod, throws to Brown. He's met immediately. Marvin Ross led the pursuit. It'll bring up third down and about 9, a loss of 3 on the play.
That's there when you're playing that boundary corner. You've got your back to the sideline. You see everything in front of you. That ball comes out of the quarterback's hand in front of you. You can lock and load and deliver a big hit on the wide receiver that's got their back turned to you.
So 3rd and 9 now. Reginald Hicks at the bottom of your screen. He's got 2 touchdowns already. LeGree steps up, throws. He's got a first down. Isaiah Thomas brings it inside the 30-yard line. 16-yard pickup. And another Hampton first down and a big third down conversion.
You know, by LeGree taking this deep drop, he's able to attack the line of scrimmage and give you the still threat of running the football, even though it looked like he had taken off and crossed the line of scrimmage. Because he was 10 yards deep, he was still behind the line and able to throw that ball.
LeGree just throws that one away, and it'll be 2nd and 10.
You know, take a look here in that previous play there. He's dropping back. He's 10 yards back. Now, right when you think he's taking off and running, see, he's in full sprint. Normally, he'd be across the line of scrimmage. He gets an extra 2 steps because of the deep drop from shotgun, and that really puts pressure on the defense.
Oh, over the middle. That's complete. It's Thomas again. He's inside the 20. Took a big hit, met by 3 Florida A&M Rattlers. Anthony Schutt finally took him down, but it's a first down.
They brought pressure again, but because LeGree is so deep, they couldn't get to him. They had the hot route right in front of him. He stood in there and delivered a good ball.
From the 14, McCain had it in his hands, but the throw just a little behind him. There's a flag on the other side of the field. Missed opportunity for Hampton, though. McCain was open.
Is this a illegal lineman downfield?
Well, yeah. Eligible man downfield, number 72 offense. 5-yard penalty.
And that's a loss of down, so 2nd down now for Hampton.
And that was on Tommy Buford. He's the backup right guard. Not going to get yourself back in that starting position going downfield when you're not supposed to. It looked odd. He was the only lineman 10 yards down the field. He thought it was a run. It was a pass play call.
Here's LeGree. Dumps it off to McLeod. Makes one man miss and then taken down by Ajay Alexander.
Good job of pursuit. You know, one thing you can tell when you see McLeod in the game, while Chisholm is out, seems like that shoulder's still bothering him. They don't lose a whole lot. They're the same type of back. Chisholm is 5'9", McLeod is 5'8". They're both 5'8 scat backs, so they're the same type of back for Coach Donovan Rose.
LeGree throws, end zone, incomplete. McCain and Thomas were there, and so was Marvin Ross for FAMU.
And this is the same throw where you want LeGree to have the ability to go over the top. Ross was beat. He doesn't throw it over the top. He throws a line drive, so watch Ross come in there, beat on the play, but manage to get a ball on, get a hand on the ball to get the deflection.
Hampton needs the 5-yard line for a first down. LeGree throws, end zone, incomplete, too high for Javaris Brown. And this will bring on the kicker to Ron Durham.
You know, you see the deep drop again, and one thing about it, when guys are coming at you, they've got full momentum. You take that deep drop, they're going to try and hit you. That was real close to being a late hit. You see Legree looking back at the official. That's one of those penalties where you're Joe Taylor. You say, why take the hit? The ball's gone from the quarterback. Let it go.
This is Durham's first field goal attempt of the season. Played last year for Nassau Community College. I'm sorry, second field goal attempt. He's already hit once in this game. And he drills this one from 34 yards.
27-yard field goal
So two field goals by Durham now, and Hampton once again has a 10-point lead. It's 20-10. Donovan Rose, he likes. With Jay Walker and Ish Schroff here on ESPNU Hampton and FAMU College Football Primetime, brought to you by Vizio, delivering entertainment freedom for all, and by Weight Watchers Online for Men, finally losing weight. 20-10, Hampton on top of FAMU. Hampton scored the first 10 points of the game. FAMU came back to make it 10-7. Then Hampton went up 17-7. Reginald Hicks, his second touchdown catch of the game. Florida A&M got a field goal before halftime. And then Hampton tacking on a 34-yard field goal by Teron Durham to make it 20-10 before we went to break. And that's where we stand with 5:30 to go here in the third quarter. Al Tariq McBurse and Jordan Stanley are deep for Florida A&M as they try to cut into this 10-point lead. This is McBurse. And he gets to the 26-yard line. ESPNU's coverage.
This is that time in the game where you need Austin Trainer to step up and lead your troops. The running game hasn't been there. They've tried to get it going. If you're going to throw the football, he's just a sophomore, but you got to step up and make some plays. You show some leadership for your team.
He was big last week against Fort Valley State, 348 yards, two TDs. They'll run it on first down. Where, I'm not exactly sure. State Farm, get to a better state.
You know, we talked about the I formation. Let's give credit to Gibson now, number four. Watch him weed his way around the football that time around. So they want to have that big 285-pound fullback in there. But what did Gibson do? Use his speed to run around Johnson that time to make the big tackle at the line of scrimmage.
So no gain, and it's second down and 10. Trainer will throw. Too high, intended receiver Kevin Elliott. All right, State Farm, get to a better state. This time we mean it. Let's see how Florida A&M can get to a better state.
Well, if you're Florida A&M, I think we saw signs of it. They've got to force feed the running game. They've got to get it going. They want to run the football. They've got to be able to do it effectively. And if you're Hampton, you know, you've got the lead. You've got to limit the penalties. That's going to be the one thing that I think can hamper them from putting this team away if they keep getting silly penalties. What do I mean by that? Unnecessary roughness, offsides. Those are more mental penalties compared to physical penalties.
Third down and 10. Florida A&M 3 of 9 on third down. They were 1 for 12 on Saturday against Division II Fort Valley State. And another flag.
Okay, they're going to reset the clock.
The play clock for 25 seconds.
You know whose name we haven't called for Florida A&M, who I thought we had to hear from?
Kevin Elliott.
Kevin Elliott. Find him. He's in the slot right now. It's time for him to step up and be the senior leader that he's supposed to be and get open in this defensive secondary.
Trainer has time, throws, and there's Kevin Elliott. Let's see where they spot it. It's going to be close.
Is that calling it forward or what? Offensive coordinator, game's getting tight. You know you don't want this to get away. You need a crucial third down conversion. Call the number of your senior wide receiver, your go-to man, Kevin Elliott. He's going to run a 15-yard in route here. He's going to be the second level throw. The first guy goes through, Kevin Elliott back there, and hold on to the ball with the concentration. That's what I'm talking about.
And it is good for a first down, so Elliott makes his mark, keeps the drive alive. Trainer again. going long.
Got him.
Got a receiver, but he overshot his man. Lenworth Lennon, the intended receiver. It was Lennon last week against Fort Valley State who caught the 68-yard game-winning touchdown. Wasn't really intended to go to him. Bounced off one player. He happened to be in the right spot and then took off, and that was all she wrote.
And he just made a football play last week that made him the hero, but what a difference a week makes. Last week, you had Trainer throwing over 300 yards. This week, completion percentage is down. Less than 100 throwing the ball. You're going to wish he had that one back because Lenworth was open.
On second down, this is McBurse. Had some room to operate, and he gets to the 45-yard line. Six-yard pickup, third and four.
You know, when you talk about those bubble screens and wearing out the team, well, I think Florida A&M said, let's do the same thing to them. Let's make the defensive lineman make some plays. Watch big number 94. He's going to go away for a while, but you're going to see him again. That's why you call team pursuit to the ball. He cuts inside. Wah! Here comes big Darrell Walker, 6'6", 270 pounds, coming right at you. You don't want to take too many shots from that guy.
That's the danger with that bubble screen. Sometimes the guy who bursts the bubble is a big old D lineman.
And the way you coach it is you tell the wide receiver, stay outside.
On third and four, there's Lennon, and he's got the first down, and he's into Hampton territory. So it's the redshirt freshman, last week's hero, with a big catch on third down. The coaching staff told us one of the goals was to get him the ball more this game.
And you can see why. He's got those football instincts. He's set up to catch that ball about a yard short of the first down marker, knew where it was, drifted backward, and was able to pick up the first down.
So the Rattlers not going away. First and 10. On the ground to Page, and he stopped short of the line of scrimmage. It'll be second and 11, loss of about a yard.
I like the call here by the Pirate defense, deciding to do some stunts. They know when Jackson comes in the game, they're going to try and play smash mouth football, running straight ahead. What do? Move your defensive line. Have them line up in one gap and just angle to the other gap. That way there's nobody to hit, and they cause confusion in the backfield. Ronald Jackson, the big fullback, didn't know who to hit, so he ended up just getting in the way.
Seeing a lot of these four wide receiver sets now from FAMU. Trainer to Lennon, and it's off his fingertips. And boy, that was close to almost being a backward pass.
Very close there. And you know, they're trying to get the ball in some playmakers' hands with the running game not being there. But you know, I don't know. I'm not too crazy about that call. Second and 10, the bubble screen. 7 yards behind the line of scrimmage.
Well, we saw the one time they tried it with Lennon, then he threw it downfield, the old wide receiver pass.
Yeah, the double pass, and I don't know if the down and distance call for it on that one when it's second and 10, and you really struggle. Every time they've gotten in across midfield, the Pirate defense done a good job of tightening up.
Kevin Elliott, number five, lined up in the slot, bottom of your screen, third down and 10. Trainer going long and too long. Fourth down coming up. LaShad Tukes was the intended target.
Dustin Rout, the nickelback from Atlanta, Georgia. Great coverage over the top.
Brandon Holdren on to punt it again. Cambrell McGee lets it bounce to the 10-yard line, and it'll bounce into the end zone. A 47-yard punt. Hampton will start from its own 20 when we come back. The Pirates up by 10 here in the third.
So you're 2:30 canceled.
Are you forgetting something? Confirmed.
My breakfast.
Get me something
delicious.
Something wholesome.
Okay.
Hampton leading Florida A&M 20-10 with 1:52 to go in the third. Time now for ESPNU's Campus Connection. a program designed to get the pulse of the campus through student-generated content. ESPNU's Campus Correction Connection correspondent Juan Diaz-Granados explains how at Hampton, the football coaches ensure the team sticks together through the demanding schedule.
Here at Hampton University, we're all about family. The football coaches mentor the players, but did you know that the players also mentor each other?
Head football coach Donovan Rose divides the team up into groups, like a real NFL draft.
A lot of the time we're in study groups, you know, helping each other, you know, with classes and things like that. You know, whatever it may be, if I'm doing something, you know, it's more than likely you'll see my group with me.
Not only does this build relationships on the field, but off the field, the players learn more about each other.
All right, thank you very much, David Legree. And Hampton certainly learning a lot about their team tonight. This was a big test. Florida A&M, really a big test for both these schools to sort of gauge where they're at. And Hampton certainly on the defensive front has been very impressive.
They have. I mean, Keith Gauguin is the defensive coordinator, has this team attacking. You know, I'm not sure if Florida A&M's going to have the ability to have a long, sustained drive throughout this game. And Legree, I think, has been the answer on offense. I mean, the big plays that they've scored, when they've scored, have been improvisations that he's done.
There's Legree, another night of the improv, and he gets to the 25-yard line.
You know, I mean, if you think about it, recognizing that they had an uncovered wide receiver, stepping up, making somebody miss when they thought he was going to run the ball, you know, those type of plays have been when he's been playing at his best. And good to see Antoine Chisholm back in the game as well, number 7, joining him in the backfield.
Chisholm gets the ball on second down, and he gets to the 28-yard line, gain of 3 yards. Joshua Newkirk, JUCO transfer, junior out of Wilmington, North Carolina, on the stop. Third and short. And a flag.
False start. Offense, number 53, 5 yards penalty. Still third down.
That's the 14th penalty on Donovan Rose's team.
And they've been the type where you just jump off sides, and I call those the mental errors. And this is something they're going to go through. You talk about having 3 transfers on the offensive line, 5 offensive linemen that have never played together. This is their first season. They don't have that type of chemistry, so they're second-guessing themselves down in the trenches.
Antonio McLeod in at running back for Chisholm. Legree on third down throws. He's got Isaiah Thomas. It's a catch, but it's short of the first down. Marvin Ross all over. Marvin Ross really has had a very good game in the secondary for Florida A&M.
I mean, he has. He's been the guy that's been active for them, playing good coverage. I mean, that last pass right there, he was over him like a blanket. Legree just beat him with a better throw.
And Ross, number 13, he's a guy who started last week, and the coaches moved him to the bench this week. He was used more in nickel packages. He got the message.
It looked like he's trying to get his job back. You know, and that's what it's all about, competition. You don't play well 1 week, but when you get that opportunity to play again, you got to make the most of your opportunity.
Hampton punting on fourth down. Jarrell Stewart.
They got a wall to the left.
Retreats to the 25.
He's got a wall.
Stewart tripped up at the 34-yard line, and he knew it. He got by one guy. He had some daylight. ESPNU's coverage of college football continues with a pair of games Saturday afternoon. Noon Eastern, it's Ryan Radcliffe in Central Michigan taking on Kentucky. Then at 3:30 Eastern, Heisman favorite Andrew Luck leads sixth-ranked Stanford against Duke. College football Saturday on ESPNU. There are a lot of doubters around the Stanford program, given their success last year, and they've lost some pieces on offense. New head coach, of course, and David Shaw, with Jim Harbaugh now at the 49ers. Jay, are you a believer in Stanford this year?
Very much so. And, you know, you've got the best player in the country. I think you've got a chance to be the best team in the country. You know, and I think with Andrew Luck coming back, and he makes wide receivers better, as we talked about. And the defense, underrated. I mean, keep in mind, they gave Oregon their toughest game last year.
They led at the half.
And they were leading.
Ronald Jackson dropped that pass on first down. He's the bulldozer, 6 foot, 285, the fullback.
Trying to show that, you know, I told him early, he's nothing but a big lineman in the backfield. He's trying to show he can run, do some route running out there, too. I take it back. You are fullback.
Second and 10, two tight ends in the game now. And that's Timms, near sideline, makes the catch at the 39, a pickup of five. It'll bring up third and five, and that might be the last play of the third quarter.
And we're taking a look there. Rattler fans know who that is. That's Quinn Gray, legendary quarterback at Florida A&M, played eight seasons in the NFL with the Jacksonville Jaguars and the Indianapolis Colts. And there's a lot of NFL coaches on these two staffs. For more, check us out on Twitter at Jay Walker ESPN. I'll tell you about the other coaches that have NFL experience.
Follow Jay on Twitter. Follow us at ESPNU on Twitter. Follow the fourth quarter. Hampton 15 minutes away from a big conference win at home. The Hampton offense good for 334 total yards so far. David Legree, a couple of touchdown passes to Reginald Hicks.
And I think that's been the difference in this contest. His big play ability, the way to improvise, and Florida A&M struggling at times. They got good balance with the run pass selection, but they have not had the ability to have long sustained drives down the field, and the Pirate defense has capitalized.
Hampton more than doubling up Florida A&M in the yards department. 334 for Hampton, 164 for FAMU. What's really hurt Hampton, 14 penalties for 97 yards, but they've capitalized on two FAMU turnovers, getting 14 points off of Rattler mistakes. Trainer will throw, and it's in and out of the hands of his intended target. That was Kevin Elliott, who would have had a big first down.
And this is one where the time is just not there. This is a very difficult throw. And to find somebody that's open there, he locked in on him, trying to squeeze that ball in that window. Linebacker there, ball was behind him. Tough catch. But you got to wonder, Trainer, what are you seeing? Was that the right window to get him the football?
On fourth and five, a short punt. It bounces at the 27-yard line. And that's where Hampton will take over. We got a big Saturday on ESPNU coming up. We'll look at some of the... At first, we have to wait for the officials. There's a flag on the play. We want to get to Saturday.
Big matchups on Saturday.
We have illegal participation on the offense. 12 men on the field. That penalty is declined. First down, Hampton.
So foul, but no harm as the penalty is declined. Hampton up 20-10. They'll take over at their own 27-yard line when we come back. Taking out 14th-ranked Arkansas and the nightcap, South Carolina State, Bethune-Cookman, key game in the MEAC, Jay.
Yeah, that's going to be a great game there. You know, early in the season, that could be make or break for who's going to determine the MEAC championship.
Joe Taylor, Florida A&M head coach, spent 16 years as Hampton's head coach, built this program. This is his second time coming back since going to FAMU. First trip ended up in a shutout loss for FAMU. Now they're down 10. Hampton with the ball. Not going anywhere. Antoine Chisholm wrapped up in the backfield. Big loss on the play. Joshua Newkirk, we've called his name a few times, getting in there to take down Chisholm for the loss.
You know, time and time again, Florida A&M's been able to have a three-man rush and get pressure on the Hampton Pirate running game. So they're still winning that battle in the trenches. Hampton not able to run the football, going solely with the pass.
That time there's that wraparound draw. That's Antonio McLeod. A gain of five, so that brings it back to about the original line of scrimmage. Third down coming up.
And this is the point in the contest where Hampton thinks they've got you beat. They just passed the 63-play threshold, so they've got 63 plays run. According to what they believe in, Florida A&M should be tiring right now, and they should be able to have their way with their offense. But it doesn't seem to be the case. The kids from Florida putting up a tough fight.
Big third down for the FAMU defense. Legree has time. Swings it out. He's got McLeod in the flat. McLeod charges his way up to the 39-yard line. He's going to be short of the first down. So fourth down coming up.
Look at Legree with the deep drop. He's 10 yards deep. That's like taking a seven-step drop underneath the center. And he gets the ball to the check down and got the ball to McLeod in a good enough stride to where McLeod was almost able to pick up the first down, but he just came up a yard short.
So it's a big stand by this FAMU defense, getting Hampton to punt. And Jeremy Tillman, speedster, waiting at his own 20-yard line for Florida A&M. And it looks like FAMU's going to go after him. They're going to send the house. And now they bring some of the guys back. Tillman at the 25-yard line, but his knee hit the ground. So Florida A&M still has time. Down two scores, but still 12:54 to go in the fourth quarter. There's time for a comeback.
So you're 2:30 canceled.
Are you forgetting something?
My breakfast.
Get me something
delicious.
Something wholesome.
Okay. I got some tasty choices. Fruit and maple oatmeal, an egg McMuffin, fruit and yogurt parfait, fruit and walnuts, and they're each 300 calories or less.
Get out of here. Good job.
The simple joy of a delicious breakfast.
She's in a really good mood.
ESPNU's College Football Primetime presented by McDonald's. I'm loving it. And in part by AutoZone. Parts are just part of what we do. Get in the zone, AutoZone. With Jay Walker and Ish Raff here at Armstrong Stadium on the campus of Hampton University. And it's Hampton with a 10-point lead here in the fourth quarter. They jumped out to an early 10-point lead. FAMU got close, but could never really get that close, and Hampton has sort of had that 10-point cushion for most of the game.
They have, and I think that's what conference football is all about. Rarely when you see two of the teams at the upper echelon of the conference does one run away with it. You know, the other ones kind of know their tendencies, and the teams settle down, the players know each other, and that's what, you know, you're going to see here, and I think it's going to be no different. Take a look at this. I'm excited, Anish. Very excited about this upcoming 2011 MEAC football schedule. I mean, look at what we've got. You know,
great game this weekend, South Carolina State at Bethune. Get you back to that schedule after this play. First and 10, FAMU, four wide receivers. Trainer throwing, nearly intercepted.
You know, and you take a look at this one. You've got Hampton taking on Bethune. Now that game, particularly if Hampton holds on to win, you know that means a whole lot there. Then Morgan State and Howard, they're gonna play in New York City. The Urban League Classic, that's a good one.
Morgan State might be a sleeper of the MEAC for the sole fact that their schedule sets up very nicely. They avoid a couple of the Giants.
Yeah, they're the beneficiaries of not having to take on South Carolina State this season. So, you know, that's a big plus. And I think the other team they don't play, do they play Florida A&M?
Don't believe they play Florida A&M.
And so they avoid those teams there. And that's something that's new for the MEAC conference as well. You know, the MEAC has expanded the conference. They've gone
11 teams.
From 9 teams to 11. So now every team in the MEAC has two opponents that they will not play. So you can be fortunate enough to not play some of the heavyweights in the division. And I think it's shaping up nicely for Don Hill and the Morgan State Bears because they get to avoid a couple of those teams.
Well, look at Hampton as well. They avoid South Carolina State. So they play Florida A&M, they play Bethune. And if they can get through the first four games, after FAMU, Hampton's got Old Dominion on the road, then Bethune-Cookman. Then the schedule very soft for Hampton the rest of the way.
And that's why that Bethune-Cookman game will take on added importance. If they can beat Bethune there, they can pretty much create some controversy on who should be the champion.
Trainer throws it up, nearly intercepted by Micah Peller. In good coverage, he was all over Jeremy Tillman.
I think what you're seeing now is kind of what we talked about. Florida A&M right now doesn't seem as if they're going to be able to have long drives, so they're relying on the big play. They're just trying to throw the ball up in the air and see what they can come down with. You know, you like to think, you know, you get better down in distance, you can maybe make a play there, but they don't have that ability, and I think they're relying upon the big play.
Fourth down coming up for FAMU, and they'll have to kick it away. So three and out for the Rattlers. Cambrell McGee muffs it. Ball is loose, picked up by Hampton. Nice save there by Dyree McCain. You want to talk about momentum nearly turning. It nearly switched in favor of FAMU, but Hampton recovers. Coming up, Jay's predictions, who he likes as the national champion. His pick might surprise you.
College football.
Football on ESPNU, Saturday at 3:30 and 7.
Losing weight clicked for me when I realized that Weight Watchers Online was for guys, too.
I'm like, it's not rainbows and lollipops.
After I read this beer cheese.
Now available at Walgreens nationwide.
Welcome back to Armstrong Stadium. Hampton up 20-10. Before we left, Florida A&M was punting. They will punt again. There was a penalty on the play. It was against Hampton. 10-yard penalty makes it 4th-and-1 now. And FAMU, 4th-and-1, still comes out in a punt formation.
You know, I would go with that heavy formation. Things aren't going your way, but they're going with the law of averages, trying to win the battle field position.
Cambrell McGee signals for a fair catch, and Hampton takes over. Before we went to break, we promised Jay's predictions for 2011, and Mr. Walker,
you know, I'm thinking
about your BCS champion. Let's start there.
Yeah. Wow. Wisconsin, I mean, a quarterback can make a difference. We saw that last year with Cam Newton and Auburn.
Now you realize that was UNLV who they ran all over.
I understand that, but Russell Wilson's a very accurate quarterback. He can get it done. Heisman Trophy, I think I tipped my hand early. I think I called Andrew Luck the best player in the land, and I'm thinking that the best player in the land will be rewarded. And I think people understand, even if he loses one game, his numbers are good enough. They'll understand that portion of it there. So I think, you know, everybody's raving about him. And then for the Walter Payton Award, what's the Walter Payton Award? That's given, that's the Heisman Trophy of FCS football. And I think that for the first time, you may have a winner from HBCU. And Casey Terrio, quarterback down at Jackson State, he can really do it.
And we will see Jackson State later this month against Texas Southern. David Legree's pass on first down incomplete, so it's 2nd down and 10. It's a run, but Chisholm is stopped for a loss by Ajay Alexander. So 3rd down coming up. Still plenty of time left in this game.
You know, and a stout Florida A&M defensive line that has not buckled the way that the Hampton Pirate offensive staff thought they would. So if they're still able to control the trenches, then that means that they can still play good defense and they may not be that fatigued.
Flag blows this play dead. Looked like Jamal Wilson may have jumped. He's the left tackle for Hampton.
Number 53 on the offense, 5-yard penalty.
It is Wilson, the Rutgers transfer, and that is the 16th penalty of the game for Hampton.
And remember when we talked about getting in a better state, and I said the one thing that Hampton has to worry about because they're on cruise control is the penalties. And the penalties in the second half have continued, and that's why Hampton's been stuck on 20 points for quite some time now.
It's a give, and not much for Chisholm.
The wraparound draw.
Yeah, he got 6, but he needed 16.
Yeah, and that's one there where, you know, they took one out the playbook of what they saw. You know, another team does that wraparound draw to you. Well, you come out and use it the next week against your opponent. And once again, Florida A&M's got an opportunity to get the ball with good field position if they can capitalize.
They came after the punter there. Here's Jarrell Stewart. He gets across the 40, has some room across midfield into Hampton territory. Cuts back, still on his feet, and down inside the 30-yard line. So FAMU already in close to field goal range. But there is a flag back at the 32-yard line of Florida A&M.
Yeah, there are two flags, and, you know, let's see. Everything looks pretty clean.
Legal block in the back. Number 13 on the receiving team. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. 1st down, FAMU.
I don't know. I want to see that. Everything I saw there seemed pretty clean. I actually saw 13 running down the field. That was Marvin Ross there. Let's take a look if we got that replay there. Let's see. 13. I mean, now if you're calling that, then that got nothing to do with it. You know, he doesn't.
Well, that's still wow. Wow.
I mean, I just call it like I see it. And in football, that had nothing to do with the play. And I don't even know if he blocked him in the back. Did he tap him on the back? If I tap you on the back, is that considered a block in the back?
Well, I'll say this. You want to talk about pendulum swings. FAMU was looking at starting inside the Hampton 30. Now They're inside their own 25. And Eddie Rocker on first down gets the call. It'll bring up second down, no gain.
Can we review that play? Can you, that would be something if you wonder they ever came to a point in time where the coaches said, I want to review the block in the back pillars.
We'd be reviewing every penalty if that ever happened.
Good point, Anish. Wow. I mean, you talk about a difference of 40-plus yards in field position with an offense that struggled to move the ball consistently down the field. I sound like a record now. They've really struggled to have sustained long drives. That could be the backbreaker.
Trainer, there's that bubble screen. He's got Elliott across the 30, and Elliott tiptoes out of bounds at about the 41-yard line, 18 yards, and a first down for Florida A&M. Again, plenty of time left.
Yeah, start looking at him. You know, everybody's going to the left. You get some downfield blocks, and Elliott does the smart thing. See, that's what seniors do. You catch the wide receiver screen, stay on the outside. There's nothing but a headache waiting for you if you cut to the inside.
Another flag out of the play.
We have unsportsmanlike conduct, number six on the defense. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
That's Dustin Root, the junior. And Florida A&M now back in business after 15 yards tacked down to the end of that play. So you spot the ball at the 44 of Hampton, and in two plays, they've made up quite a few yards. Timeout on the field, and while we have a minute, we remind you that Saturday morning, ESPNU previews a full day of college football. 9 a.m. Eastern, Aaron Andrews and David Pollack bring you College Game Day, built by the Home Depot. Then at 10 a.m. Eastern, it's a special college football version of Sports Nation. And at 11, it's The Whip, the show that gets the latest from all the game sites just prior to kickoff. College football lives on ESPNU. Of course, you can follow ESPNU on Twitter, at ESPNU. That's the Twitter handle. Hampton leading FAMU 20-10. And if the score holds, it would certainly mean a shakeup for at least part of the Sheridan top 10.
Well, you can just swap number 8 and number 5. I think Hampton would jump ahead of Florida A&M. And then I think some of the, you know, the matchup this weekend between South Carolina State and Bethune, if one of those teams gets beat badly, they'll drop enough. And Albany State Division II program, they're very physical. They're going to postseason. And Grambling, the job there, Grambling. But I'll tell you, one of the sleepers to watch out for, one of the sleepers, they got a transfer quarterback at Alabama State named Greg Jenkins, transferred from Troy. And Alabama State made it to the SWAC championship game last year. If Jenkins can continue to play the way he played last week's game, look for the Hornets to be tough to beat.
We saw Tuskegee, another Division II program on there. We called their Turkey Day Classic last year against Alabama State. Tuskegee last year beat the two teams, Texas Southern and Alabama State, who played in the SWAC championship.
I've been Tuskegee's right there again. That's just a program that year in, year out, very competitive.
Trainer going long, and it's picked off by Micah Pellerin. Intercepted at the 19-yard line by the senior, the former transfer from Southern Miss.
They're relying on the big play, and Pellerin's a guy that they say grades out at a higher NFL score than Kendrick Ellis did last year. Good job of recognizing where the ball was and attacking and coming and getting the interception. You know, he's a guy they just raved about yesterday in the practice. They talked about how he's got great feet, good character guy there. He's got the frame at 6 feet, almost 2 inches, 200 pounds, where he can either project as a safety or a quarterback in the NFL. And you saw the good ball skills there.
First team All-MEAC in the preseason. Actually had an interception against FAMU last year. And when we talked to the secondary coach, Ray Lewis, he said Pellerin's going to have a big impact in this game, and he got the pick there. Here's McLeod, charges up the middle. Gain of about 2 or 3, it'll bring up second down.
And that's one of those plays you want your senior preseason all-conference quarterback to make. Other team starts to mount a drive, gets the ball in scoring position, come up with the big play.
On the ground again, and it's McLeod again. shedding tacklers past the 40-yard line. 17 yards, and a fresh set of downs for Hampton.
On the past two plays, number 53, Jamal Wilson on the left side, right side, has been able to cave his man in and just pancake the opposing Rattler defender. So maybe, just maybe now, the Rattlers are starting to tire a little bit within their front seven.
That time, good pressure by FAMU, and McLeod not able to get much. Lost a yard, second and 11.
When you see the big guys there, they're sucking up some oxygen there, and you start seeing those hands on hips, and that's a good sign right there. And also some of the linebackers trying to get in some extra air.
On the ground, this is Chisholm, loses his balance, regains his footing, and he's off to the races. Down inside the 30-yard line, a gain of nearly 30. Brandon Hepburn finally took him down. And Hampton had not been able to run the ball all game until really this drive now.
Yeah, and you know, and they got it with the good line play. Big Vincent Harper there, the center, getting up to the second level and able to get on that linebacker.
Keep it on the ground once again. This is McLeod around the left side, and he's inside the 15-yard line. There is a flag on the play, though.
About illegal substitution. Illegal substitution on the defense. That's a 5-yard penalty. That is declined. Results of the play.
Now let's go back to that long run there. Take a look in the middle of your screen. You're going to watch the center, Vincent Harper, get to the second level. Slip block one guy and then get up there to the second level and boom, push him back. Nowhere for the defender to go. Chisholm saw the daylight to the outside on the twist. Big play for the Pirates.
First and 10 from the 14. Another run, it's McLeod right up the middle, and he's inside the 10-yard line. 6 yards, and it's second down and 4.
And another play there where the interior linemen for Hampton are able to get to the second level. That time it was right guard Corey Alpici getting up on the linebacker and sealing the block. So they're starting to get upfield where they want to go.
That's Christopher Dukes, 5'8 freshman from Mobile, Alabama.
And he's a guy they think is going to be a special player. He rushed for over 5,000 yards in his high school career, and they went down and snuck him from the state of Alabama.
Third and 2. It's Chisholm now back in the game. Hampton has gone this far without throwing it once on this drive. And they'll stay on the ground to Chisholm, and he's going to be stopped short. And did he maintain possession? He did, but looks like he's going to be short of the first down. So it's fourth down coming up, and this is big here because a field goal, and it's still a 2-possession game. Obviously a touchdown, and then it's a 3-possession game and almost over.
Yeah, another missed opportunity to put this team away. You'll see towards the end of the run, the ball comes out. Chisholm was bent over all different types of ways, but you know, we talked about it. You let them hang around, you let them hang around, and once again, Hampton showing the inability to put this Florida A&M team away.
Teron Durham on for a field goal attempt, a 24-yarder. Durham's kick is good. His third field goal of the evening. He's hit from 23, 34, and now 24. Florida A&M down 13. Still has a pulse, though, with 5:56 to go.
When you join together talented student athletes with great coaches at wonderful institutions of higher learning, you have all the resources you need to achieve success. The Mideastern Athletic Conference was established on the principles of educating and preparing student athletes for the game of life. Comprised of 13 outstanding institutions, the MEAC continues its tradition of athletic dominance on the playing field and academic success in the classroom. The Mideastern Athletic Conference, celebrating excellence.
Back here at Armstrong Stadium, home opener for Hampton, and they lead Florida A&M 23-10 with Jay Walker. Ivan Ashraf, low scoring second half.
The Force.
Are we keeping the drummer engaged?
The Hampton Force. Very entertaining band, part of the drum line.
His eyes were wandering. He was looking for direction.
I like the Force. You know, one thing about it, I'm a big fan of those bands that are active during the game. You know, they do a good job scoring on touchdown, but when your team has the ball on offense, you got to figure out a way to play in between every single snap. Now, maybe it's because they've got this no-huddle offense. We don't hear from them when they've got the ball on offense. Got to change that up. You know, you don't want your environment to be rowdy. Wouldn't you agree upon that?
I would agree. We have seen certain bands where we can't hear each other talk because they're playing on every single play. This is Al-Tariq McBurse. Makes one man miss. Gets outside to about the 33-yard line. And that's where FAMU will start.
All right, I got to, you know, I was giving credit to my guy, big fullback, Ronald Jackson for Florida A&M. He's the up man on special teams on kickoff return, right? So, you know, you get him back there second level, he should be able to go hit somebody pretty hard. He completely whiffed on that last one. You know, you see what I'm talking about? You'll see, look on the right side. That's him on the bottom of your screen there.
Number 44.
The next time you see him, look at him. He's on the ground, didn't touch a soul. Just died. Look, two times he was 0-for-2. take a look. You'll see it there. He's getting up, and he's going to come in there again, and no, didn't do it.
Key drive here for FAMU, down two scores on first down. It's a draw play, and not much, if anything. So they tried to run the ball, maybe trying to catch Hampton off guard, but Eddie Rocker dropped at the line of scrimmage. Florida A&M is yet to score in the second half. Less than 5.5 to play. Swing pass to Rocker. Rocker's got a first down and more, but there's a flag back at about the 37-yard line. Let's go down to the third member of our crew, Preston Harding.
No, you didn't. Had to put him on the payroll for this game, huh?
I think he may have talked more than we have tonight.
We have holding. Number 5 offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Okay. They're declining.
So Hampton declines the penalty. Don't forget the Lexus post-game report.
Hampton
immediately following
this
game.
They declined the holding penalty.
Holding, number 5 offense. That's a 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Second down.
I'm assuming he's saying that because they're accepting the penalty.
They're accepting the penalty. The initial report from Preston Harding was Hampton declined it. The correction, now they're accepting it. Florida A&M, you look at the pass versus rush distribution, 36 passes, 24 runs. Time of possession about even. Part of that is because Hampton plays so fast. So it's a little misleading. Second and 20. Trainer completes to Timms. Timms still on his feet. Off to the races. And Brandon Timms finally forced out of bounds by Justin Blake, who saved the touchdown. But hang on a second, Florida A&M.
Yeah, this
heart's still beating.
You know, just an athletic play there. You know, spin move to the outside and keep your balance. And did he stay in bounds? Yes, he did. Yes, he did. Great job there with the balance. Official right there on it.
It's a 63-yard gain, and all of a sudden, Florida A&M with the ball at the 10-yard line.
Now you want to score quick here, but don't be in a hurry. You know, don't be in such a hurry that you miss a call, you miss an assignment, you get a sack. They need to score a touchdown, so they got to take 4 shots at the end zone.
They're waiting on the chain gang to get down there. First and goal. Now another whistle.
Delay of game offense. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
So another penalty. And this is first and 15 now.
And this is the mindset you have to have as a quarterback. You go in your huddle, you say, hey, they moved us back 5 yards. That just gave us more room to operate in the red zone. We're going to go get this done. Every now and then as a quarterback, you knew you had to throw. Give me a little bit more space. Make the defense defend more of the field compared to when you're in there compact and tight.
We'll keep it on the ground, but Eddie Rocker gets rocked in the backfield.
No time for
loss of a yard.
No time for the
runner. Ian Davidson getting in there. Yeah, second down now.
Second down. You know, they've got to burn a timeout.
And they need six here. Three doesn't do them any good.
Yeah, that's one. That's kind of a waste of a play. That's one where you got to sit there and tell your offensive unit, hey, we got four shots. We're going to come out throwing the ball there unless you absolutely see something that you like with a number count in the box.
Following your game, we'll send you back to the Sports Center U studio to get you caught up on all the action from this opening week of college football. Mike Leeson standing by. Second week starting really tonight. Oklahoma State, Arizona. Excited to see what transpired in that game.
I think sooner or later.
Well, Florida A&M not quite dead yet. 3:48 to go. They can get a score here. All of a sudden it makes things interesting. Puts the pressure on that Hampton offense. Second and goal from the 15. Trainer throws, completes to Rocker, slips one tackler, hurdles another, and he gets inside the 10. Ball comes loose, but he was already down.
I mean, I thought he was down 10 yards ago. You know, in the college game, you know, the official was right there, so he should have a good look at it. In college game, once you slip, you're down. And he's down. He's down.
Now they can review that. Third and goal. And now it looks as the officials will review that. Again, instant replay in effect for televised MEAC games this season.
The previous play is under review.
Jay, you called this right away.
Yeah, I mean, you know, in college, when a guy struggles and goes that low, unless he makes a remarkable play, he's down and he's got the hand down.
Yep, the
knees right
down,
there, yeah, down as well. Down. You know, I almost thought the ball was down. He did a pretty good job of trying to keep his balance. But, I mean, clearly, you can tell that knee's down right there on the ground.
So, essentially, we're looking at a two-down territory, and we'll have a new spot. So, let's see. It's tough to tell where he exactly goes down from that angle. But over here, let's see. He goes down right at the 16-17 yard line. So it's going to be either, you know, a gain of a yard maybe at the most, no gain. So you've got two plays now.
And stop the sideway passing. I'm just curious about the run on first down, and then you come out and you throw, you know, a wide receiver screen on second down. You've got to get into the end zone. Not a lot of real estate. There's no place for them to back up to.
Okay, so what do you call here?
I mean, you call one of your rub plays.
Review, the runner's knee did touch the ground at the 17-yard line. It would be third and goal from the 17. Please reset the game clock to 3:47. 3:47. Third down.
So third and goal from the 17 now. And again, this is two down territory. And Preston Harding's defense, he's had quite a workout down on the field.
I mean, he's had a workout with
the head referee.
You know, if Florida A&M, send one guy down the middle of the field, have another wide receiver on the outside, and maybe try and give yourself a one-on-one jump ball opportunity.
He's looking for Timms, who goes down. Flag comes in. That was Mike Peller in covering Timms. And you saw Timms go down, and he sold it.
There was no question about that one. Mike Peller was there about 3 seconds too early, and the ball only took a second to get there. Can't run through the receiver like that. Even if it's an uncatchable ball, when you hit him as early as Michael Pellerin did, then, you know, the officials got to call that. So now it's going to be a first down for Florida A&M. And what did we say all day? The problem's been these penalties
for Hampton.
Keeping them in the football game.
We have defensive pass interference. Number 15, spot foul, automatic first down.
That's huge.
That is the 18th penalty for the Hampton Pirates.
And that's a huge one right there. Instead of a team having fourth and goal from the 16-yard line, now it's first and goal from the four. The Rattlers still have life.
And another flag.
There's a flag on the play.
Be first and goal from the 2-yard line now.
We're going to be seeing yellow in our dreams tonight.
Defense, number 94, offside, half the distance to the goal, still first down.
So Donovan Rose's Pirates have now committed 19 penalties. That, by the way, was the exact number that FAMU committed in its season opener against Fort Valley State. So, first down and goal now from the two.
Look who's in the game. That's the fullback.
Number 44, Ronald Jackson. We'll go to the deep back in the eye. It's Levante Page fighting for the end zone, and he's going to be short. So it'll be second and goal, and this means time used to run off that clock.
Yeah, you know, see, they overloaded. They knew that. So they said, well, if you've got 285 pounds coming at us, then we're going to put two people in that hole and make him pick one to hit. And they did. Now, this is the time where, although you ran the ball, hurry up, get back up to the line of scrimmage, get it going. See, if they end up scoring, they're going to need this time. It's ticking off the clock right now.
Second and goal now from the three. Page again. And he still can't get through that line. It'll bring up third and goal.
See, get him up there. Get him right up to the line of scrimmage right now. Same package. You're going straight ahead anyway. This is where trainers got to get a sense of urgency with this team. The Florida A&M sideline is telling them, clock it, do the same play. But they sat there and watched 15 seconds tick off the clock.
All right, trainer gets his team back to the line. Another handoff. Page up the middle, and he is in for his second touchdown of the game. And with 2:19 to go, FAMU makes it 23-16.
That's a touchdown for the Rams.
Well, Anish.
Still not over. That's a 7-play, 66-yard drive. All in 3 minutes and 30 seconds. Trevor Scott on for the point after. It's good. So 23-17. Okay, if you're Joe Taylor now. Too early for the onside kick, or?
I mean, you got to look at your timeouts, and I think they've got 2:52 when they run this play. We'll answer your question, and he's 2:52. Plays over at 2:47. It does not take you the full 32 seconds because the linemen don't have to come back from being downfield after a long play. You need the quarterback to be telling everybody, come on, let's go, let's go, let's go. He's standing around looking, looking. Now he says, let's start to run the play. And at that point in time, the clock is just continuing to tick, continuing to tick. That's game management there. They may end up needing those 20 seconds back, especially if they don't recover an onside kick.
They've got one timeout, 2:19 to go. So if you're Joe Taylor, I mean, is the onside kick the call here?
I would go onside.
With 2:19 to go.
I would go onside kick. You know, considering they've only got one timeout there. You know, if Hampton gets the ball right back there where they are they in field goal position? No, but they would need to get a first down, but your defense would have to make a stop.
FAMU lining up for the onside kick. I'm having flashbacks to that Auburn-Utah State game from week one.
Yeah.
Remember Utah State, similar instance. They were up by 10. Auburn scores, onside kick, they recover, and then take it right back down.
Yeah.
And win the game.
You know, if you don't put a team away, you know, good teams will come back and find a way to make it interesting at the end. You know, not to tell my age, but mom used to always tell me, if you play with your food and you don't eat it, don't be mad when somebody comes and they take your plate from it.
And Florida A&M has used its third and final timeout.
They're all in. You know, at that point, they're all in. So the game is going to be made, you know, won or lost right now on this play.
Saturday on ESPNU, a full slate of terrific games. Central Michigan, Kentucky, Stanford, and Duke, New Mexico, Arkansas, And then the nightcap, 10:30 Eastern, South Carolina State and Bethune-Cookman. That's a pivotal early season game in the MEAC, as is this one between FAMU and Hampton. As for Stanford and the Cardinal, Andrew Luck, he's your guy. You think he's going to win the Heisman?
Yeah, I think he will. You know, he only played a half of a game last week. Got in a little bit in the third quarter versus San Jose State. You know, RG3, Robert Griffin III, really stepped up in Baylor. He's probably, you know, in terms of name recognition and performance-wise, Robert Griffin's up there. And I think he'd look for Luck to try and rebound and get his name up there as well with a big day versus Duke.
Almost as shocking as what Robert Griffin III did was a Gary Patterson defense getting torched for 50 points. They were number one in college football in total defense the last 3 years.
And of course, people will say they lost some people to graduation.
They lose six starters.
Which they did. But the fact what you're saying, it's a Gary Patterson coach defense. He's a defensive coordinator that's a head coach that hangs his hat on his defense. That makes that performance by Robert Griffin III even that more impressive.
Florida A&M. Now, they're, let's see if they line up here for the onside kick. It doesn't seem like it.
They've got to. I mean, if you called the timeout, you know, and you now have no timeout, you got to pretty much be saying you're.
And now Hampton wants to call timeout. So the chess match continues between Joe Taylor and Donovan Rose. Mentor and protege. Don't forget SportsCenter, you next on ESPNU. Mike Gleason waiting in studio. I think Mike remembers that the final 10 seconds of the first half took, what?
10 minutes.
10 minutes?
So we'll get to Mike.
He might have time to get some food.
Yeah. Go ahead and get a midnight snack. Get to him about 12:45.
23-17. Hampton against FAMU. Okay, so FAMU comes out. They don't line up in an onside formation. Do you read into that?
No. You know, and I think if you're...
Was that on purpose then?
Maybe so. And maybe they were going to swing the offense over at the last minute, move people from one side to the other. And they're still coming out and lined up. And maybe they just don't want to tip their hand so obvious for where they're going with the football. And it seems to be working because right now there's some confusion on the return team for Hampton. They're playing the short punt, the pooch kick.
Crucial play in this game. Let's see what Trevor Scott does. He'll kick it deep. Cambrell McGee is going to run it out, and he's going to be dropped at about his own 12-yard line. So it looked like it was going to be the onside kick, that maybe an onside kick, but not from an onside formation. Instead, FAMU elects to kick it deep.
And for the simple fact that, you know, Joe Taylor is going to forget more football than I'll ever learn, and he's won all these games, I'm not going to question that. But I do have to question, why the call timeout if you plan on allowing your defense an opportunity to make a play?
Okay, well, they kick it deep. Now, take us into Joe Taylor's thinking. What's the motive there to not do an onside kick?
I have no idea. I really don't, you know. I guess, you know, they're thinking maybe their game, if they defense can make some stops and there's 8 or 9 seconds, force them to punt the football as opposed to giving them
zone.
A field goal, and maybe you can block it or get a return.
Hampton runs it on first down. Not much for Antonio McLeod. DJ Folsom on the stop. Clock continues to run.
Now imagine
second and 10.
If they get the ball back, don't you think they're going to wish they had that 32 seconds back that they sat on the goal line taking their time and didn't get in a hurry? It's a very questionable play selection and calls this last 2 minutes of this football game.
Hampton content to run some clock here. Play clock down to 5. Down to 3. Legree, the snap. It's Christopher Dukes right up the gut. Gain of 5 yards. It'll bring up third down. Play of the game right here for FAMU. Uh-huh. They need a stop. They don't get a stop. Essentially, this game is over.
You know, we'll see how aggressive the offense will be from Hampton right now. Do you throw the ball in the air to actually go for the first down and win the football game? Or do you play the percentages, keep it on the ground, and if Florida A&M gets the ball back, let them have very little clock to work with?
Let's put it this way. You got about a minute left. The play clock's at 13. So you figure they call the play with, what, about 47 seconds left? Yeah. Then you can allow another 40 seconds to run off.
Yeah.
So FAMU's not going to have much time. It's a run right up the middle. Christopher Dukes doesn't get much.
That's good.
And yeah, I think mission accomplished for Hampton.
What do you have, about a 2 second differential?
It's about a 2 second differential, maybe a second and a half between game clock and play clock.
See, I wouldn't come off the field. I keep my quarterback on the field.
And you just do a drop back.
Two steps back.
Take the kneel.
And fall down.
Now, let's see, Hampton could even take the delay here.
So we've got about a 1.5, 2 second differential there in which they've got to do. So this
play clock is
making
three
sure they do the
now.
Right thing.
Let's see if Hampton just takes the delay. It looks like they will. They also have a timeout.
Victory, take 1 second off and run. Hold on, offense.
Five-yard penalty, fourth down.
So Donovan Rose and Hampton, they elect to take the delay. 1 second left, and it's fourth down. This game pretty much over.
Yeah, you know, this one you get that
six. You don't have to punt here.
No, you do that six tight diamond formation, have some blockers up there. Three-step drop from your quarterback down on the ground.
And now put 2 seconds on the scoreboard. Don't forget, Saturday, noon Eastern on ESPNU. Central Michigan, Kentucky. Then at 3:30 Eastern, Stanford, ranked sixth of the nation, behind Andrew Luck, taking on Duke, New Mexico, Arkansas, South Carolina State, Bethune-Cookman, big game of the MEAC. That's the nightcap. And now timeout Hampton with 2 seconds left. Mike Leeson's got time to order out.
I mean, they just talked about it. They took the delay. The whole offense was there.
So, Jay, if you're Donovan Rose, you don't punt here. You just have the quarterback take a few steps back, take a knee.
Yeah, the only way you think about it is if you got 3 or 4 seconds on the clock.
Right.
They've got a second. That's snap the ball, take 2 steps back, take a knee.
Looking at Florida A&M's upcoming schedule, they're at South Florida, then home against Southern. Then they have a little soft spot, Delaware State, Howard, Savannah State. Look at the last four games, though. South Carolina State on the road, and then home against Bethune-Cookman, the Florida Classic. Last year, FAMU was the only team in the MEAC to beat Bethune.
Yeah, you know, and that's a neutral game played in Orlando. And I think the key there is when they beat Bethune last year, that made it a three-way tie for the MEAC race. Yeah, co-champion. So if they lose this one here, they'll still have an opportunity.
Hampton able to run out the clock. And we have a final here from Armstrong Stadium. Donovan Rose beats his old boss, Joe Taylor. Hampton gets its first win in the MEAC. The Pirates win their home opener. Final score here, 23-17. Hampton with the W.
Well, we knew that Hampton was a team that had the talent to do it. Fast-paced offense. David Legree is continuing to grow before our eyes as a quarterback and a very stingy defense.
And the way the schedule sets up for Hampton, they avoid South Carolina State. This is a team now with a very real chance, perhaps, of doing some things in the MEAC Conference this season. Once again, our final score from Armstrong Stadium, Hampton 23, Florida A&M 17. For Jay Walker, Ivan A. Schroff saying good night from Hampton, Virginia. Now let's get you to SportsCenter U and Mike Leeson.
This is SportsCenter U.